Okay, we are live streaming. So welcome everyone to the 6th Annual Land Resources Forum. My name is Scott Clark. I'll be your host for the next couple of days, and we'll do a recap in just a minute or two. But I'd like to call on Kokomas Evan McLeod to get us started. Evelyn, would you get us started?
Mm-hmm. Bonjour, Kinawea.
Miigwech, Evelyn. Well, welcome everybody to Wednesday and day two of the Land and Resources Forum. Just a couple of housekeeping items here. So we're going to move all the way through right till noon today. So if you need a health break at any time, just take a health break. Remember that we're recording this. We're streaming it also onto YouTube as well. Any of the presentations that you're seeing, we're hoping to get all these presentations so we can post them on landandresources.ca. That website, so you can access them. The other thing I want to let everybody know that I scan all the microphones at a certain time for the panelists, basically. And if I see a microphone on, I'll just mute it, just to be safe. So if you're all of a sudden you see your microphone muted, that's probably me doing that. It's nothing wrong with the system or what's taking place. It's me looking after you with a live mic. So that's happened. That's some of the housekeeping items. So let's do a recap from yesterday. And again, miigwech to all our participants and everyone involved. We started off the forum with a leadership panel discussing the impacts of climate change and also negotiating requirements for resources revenue sharing and how both of these topics relate and affect the Anishinaabeg First Nations. Grand Council Chief Reg Niganabi discussed revenue resource sharing and how this shouldn't be policy-based initiative, but a conversation to honor treaties. The Nation Council's panel shared their thoughts and stories regarding environmental changes and how the Anishinaabe people can work together in unity to preserve what we have today. And Invasive Species Center shared information about protecting lands and waters in continued effort to support the Anishinaabeg First Nations, and also gave a link to additional resources. And if you didn't receive that, we'll make sure we push that your way. So that's a bit of a recap from yesterday. Today, we're going to learn about the Wampum Belt that you see. Not this one here, but this one here. We'll learn about that in just a moment. Also, we're going to hear from Westaway Law Group about climate change and food security study. And then we'll be wrapping up this morning with the Ontario relationship with Anishinaabeg Nation, some of the ministry updates, and Lori Churchill will be joining us from, Lori is the Director of Indigenous Consultation and Partnership Branch, and she has a whole slew of friends that will be joining her as well. I'm going to let her introduce all her friends. So at this moment, I'd like to welcome Alan Corbe, who will share teaching of this year's Wampum Belt. Alan, are you here? There's Alan there. Miigwech, Alan, I'm gonna hand it over to you now. Do you need anything from me?
Did you enable sharing?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
It's all yours.
All right. Evelyn Balkanung Manda Mongidwing. First, I want to thank Evelyn for opening this up. Meanwhile, Dash Nishnabe Duk Nin So Jik Bneb Do Dem Chiging Don Jaba Chinan Dam Dash Wikijuno Gazian, we bid the Batama Gajue Bakman P. Meanwhile, Dash Nui the Batan Migis Pekan Gado Nagan and Ah Ejnikadek. I want to thank the organizers, the elders, Getsepitsijik, Getsijik, Minoa, the Ogemak, Minoa Giron and Oak, Naganzijik, Niganzijik, Minoa Nijinishnabek. I want to thank our chiefs, our speakers, our counselors, as well as all of our fellow Nishnabek for inviting me here to speak a bit. I'll just cut me off. I was trying to trim this down a bit more. I'm trying to think of I'm hoping this is going to become a chapter of my book at some point. So I keep playing around with this. Anyway, I'm happy to be here, and I'm glad that I was asked again to show up. And
Alan,
if I can
just interrupt one, could you share your screen one more time? I might have clicked you off there. Sorry, that was my fault.
Okay. Well, okay. I think we're good.
Yes.
Okay. Dango dash moshkine apkeze o kukumisana debikigizis. So today it's close to the full moon. And so moshkini up because it oh the big Jesus, Mishike ba gibindo de ore, but those are winning. So today, when it's a full moon, I'm thinking of our late elder Mishike ba, because every full moon, he had to do that sweat. He would climb in, crawl into that sweat. Nangurunong dasha geni gibindo de. So I would also climb into that, crawl into that sweat with him from time to time. And so I'm thinking of him today, and I wanted to actually ask him about this, and I never got a chance to sit down and talk about this more in depth. One thing I want to start off with is we talk about it as our dish. Noggin, Gado Noggin, and now. And what I wanted to mention to all of you here as Anishinaabe people, you think of this dish and this land, as well as our ancestors and all of the creation. Many of you know that when we have our feasts, we put out one dish for those ancestors and for the rest of creation. So I want you to try and think of that a bit more as I go through this. There's two types of feasts, one for the deceased and one for who we call the Atzokanak. Some would say Gamindominanak, but others would say Gadodemonanak, meanwhile Gadatzokanak, to all those spirits that help us and guide us. Anyway, there's two different kinds. And in that, the one you usually see is everyone, all the dishes are laid out And then they'll take a bit of food for from all the plates that are already existing, and then they put a set aside a dish just like somebody else, one person. And the other way is actually everyone gets served their dish, and then they take a bit from each of their, a bit of the food that's on their plate, and then they put it in one big bowl. So there's a, there's two different ways for the both of those two different types of feasts. So just keep that in the back of your mind when we're going through this, when we talk about our dish, and that how Anishinaabe people, what we continue to do is to set aside that dish for all of us, for future generations. Meanwhile, Gagiwejik, Ganiganzijik, meanwhile, Wabiyajik, Wabibimadzijik. So we think of those ones that have gone on, but also those ones that are actually coming yet. So the goals of this presentation, and remind me, just cut me off when I've gone too long, but I want you to, I'm trying to work through and contemplate the origins of the dish. Right now, the Haudenosaunee narrative is the one that's the dominant one. Their understanding of it is the dominant one. And I want to try and get the Anishinaabe version of this out there a bit more. And then I want to gain a greater appreciation of the metaphor of the dish and to remember that this is a symbolic. And then to gain an understanding of the geographical extent and the temporal duration of the dish, how long this has been as used as a metaphor and how far and wide people understand this metaphor. And then to consider whether it is a territorial or a peace agreement. So that's my goals. I first heard of this from the fella on your left. This is Jake Thomas. When I went to University of Toronto, we had him often come to the University of Toronto, and I'd also see him at the Trent University. He was a remarkable man. Apparently he could speak all six of the Haudenosaunee languages, but impressive of that is he would recite their great law, and I know he could do it in Cayuga, and I'm assuming that he could do it recite that law in all six languages. But the remarkable thing is that law, to recite that law, took 10 days. So this is this was a remarkable man, and one of their Cayuga chiefs, Longhouse chiefs. Anyway. In 1993, he provided the following to the Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples. And this is his understanding as was handed down to him by his elders about the dish with one spoon. We shall only have one dish or bowl in which will be placed one beaver's tail, and we shall all have co-equal right to it. And there shall be no knife in it. But if there be a knife in it, there would be danger that it could cut someone and blood would thereby be shed. This one dish or bowl signified that they make their grounds one common tract and all have co-equal right to hunt in it. The knife being prohibited from being placed into the dish or bowl signifies that all danger would be removed. So keep those in mind, that one, that there's a dish, a bowl, and no knife, and then also the beaver's tail in there. So here on the right is Gagiwe Kwaneb, and he was known as Sacred Feathers in English, Gagiwe Kwaneb, and he was Peter Jones in English, and he was a Methodist missionary, but he was an Anishinaabe, and he was from the Credit. But he wrote down and published a book called The History of the Ojibwe People, with a special reference to their conversion to Christianity. But he has quite a bit of the treaties in there. So he says the first treaty between the Haudenosaunee and the Anishinaabe made between the Six Nations and the Ojibwe. This treaty was made many years ago when the Great Council was held at the east end of Lake Ontario. The belt was in the form of a dish or bowl in the center, which the chief said represented that the Ojibwe's and Six Nations were all to eat out of the same dish, that is, to have all their game in common. In the center of the bowl were a few white wampums, which represented a beaver's tail, the favorite dish of the Ojibwe's. So again, largely, there's no mention of the knife. And there's actually, he doesn't really mention the bowl, I mean, a spoon. Anyway, but he does mention the beaver's tail and the dish, and that is a co-equal right to hunting territories. So largely the same. When I started reading more and more, I started seeing that just like how we say, many of you will know or have heard that there's a war pipe and there's a peace pipe. And also you will also, maybe you have heard that there's a peace belt, wampum belt, and there's a war belt. You may have heard that as well. So back in the earlier days, there actually was a kettle of peace and a kettle of war as well. So this started to make me think more about what the metaphors are, because they have this dual aspect all the time. And it's just like our medicines. Our medicines actually have these dual aspects. Some of them have dual aspects. But so earlier on, this was called the Feast of the Dead. And this is a painting of it that was done later on. But it has many of the elements in it that I wanted to share. These were Huron Wendat people that were most famous for this ceremony. And it was a grand ceremony to have thousands of people there. And the people from all around would bring the bones of their deceased there. And they would clean those bones up. And then they would wrap them in beaver robes, and they would put them all in one common grave or ossuary. So the Huron called it Yandatsa. That was what the French called the Feast of the Dead, but the Huron Wendat people call it Yandatsa, which just meant kettle. So they had all these metaphors that go with it. So when they said it's they stir the ashes beneath the kettle, it meant that they were going to hasten the arrival of the feast. And if they overturned the kettle, it meant to decide against having a feast. And then in 1636, the Huron had groups of four people of the cord, people of the bear, people of the deer, and people of the rock. But they couldn't come to agree. There was some dispute, internal division. So they held off, and they were going to hold off having the feast, but they ended up deciding two factions had two different feasts. And so they said the kettle is divided. Anyway, at one point, the Nipissing people actually went to the feast. They attended it, and they liked it so much that they then hosted it as well. And they added, of course, their own flourishes. So when I talked about looking at possible origins of this metaphor, the dish, this is one of the places that I think might have been one of the origins of that. But I haven't proven that. This is just my current thinking. So the other thing that I latched onto with this, there's a description of the ceremony. And they said they lined the burial pit with beaver robes. These individuals covered the bottom and sides of the pit with 48 robes. And beaver pelts per robe. This represented yet more evidence of the Wendat's material devotion to the dead. So basically 48 beaver robes, but there's 10 pelts in each of them. So you see how massive this, the amount of beaver that actually went into that pit. And then that's not even talking about the individually wrapped bones. They were also wrapped in beaver skins. So again, we got this this pit, which can be seen, looks like a bowl as well. But then all the bones of our ancestors and people that are our enemies could have been our enemies before or our allies. And then mixing them all together and then wrapping them in that beaver hide instead of the beaver tail. So there's just a lot of parallels there. Anyway, as many of you have known or heard, there was a great war here. Many battles between our Haudenosaunee brothers and the Anishinaabe people. This is a map taken from the Great Lakes Indian Atlas. But what I wanted to do was to then find, because I noticed that some of the elders in our area talked about different places and those places didn't make it on the map. So I started putting those on. And here are some of the recorded ones that from our area, what we would call Gwekwekajawang by Algoma Mills. And then, of course, Mount McBean, Nadawayojing. And then Ashidopkissening, that's by Willisville, Ontario. Nadawaysing. That's on La Cloche, And then the head skull island or head island, Pukunda Bay, Minis, and then around by Wasoxing as well. So these are battles that that we ended up winning. So here in 1690, after these victories, the Anishinaabe started to push back. Initially, the Haudenosaunee pushed us west and north, but then we regrouped and then we pushed them back and we ended up having some significant victories. So they actually came and they asked us for peace. They're the ones that came to us for peace. And so in 1690, they came up to Michilimackinac, the Haudenosaunee did. And I'm going to read this, and it's a bit, it may be a bit lengthy, but I think it's important to hear. So as for the Iroquois, they had sent these tribes eight collars, meaning wampum belts. By the first, they said they remembered the peace they made with La Petite Racine, and that they had not desired to break it, even though their brothers, the Odawa, should kill them every day. By the second wampum belt, they buried all the dead whom their brothers had slain. The third hung up a sun at the strait between Lake Erie and Lake Huron, which should mark the boundaries between the two peoples, and this sun should give them light when they were hunting. So at that particular point, that's at, of course, Detroit River. We don't know exactly where they hung that up, or if it's at Lake St. Clair, but hanging up the sun over there to mark the boundaries, this will come, will be revisited in future slides, as well as by future ancestors' speeches when I talk here. Anyway, it's important to talk again about that, this notion of the sun being hung up, as well as it'll be a recurring motif in these discussions between the Haudenosaunee people and the Anishinaabe. And they said that by the fourth wampum belt, they threw into the lake and into the depths of the earth the blood that had been shed in order that nothing may be tainted with it. By the fifth, they sent their own bowl so that they might have but one dish from which to eat and drink. So this again, they're at Michilimackinac, this is at Michilimackinac, but they had already done a ceremony and a peace, effecting a peace over by St. Clair. By this, promise to eat the wild beasts around them, which should be common enemies to both. So that again, remember I was talking about this metaphor of a war belt, peace belt, war pipe, peace, war pipe, peace pipe. And then here, war kettle and peace kettle. And here, so they say they're going to eat their enemies. But that's a figurative way. It isn't necessarily cannibalism. It's actually incorporating them into their population as well, making them captives and adopting them into their nations to replenish those that they have lost. So that's what these belts were as well. But then what he also noted was that the Odawa there confirmed these by means of collars, meaning wampum belts, red stone calumets, and bales of beaver skin. So this was how they actually solidified that peace. It was the Anishinaabe that used the red stone pipe and the calumet stem pipe. And then also they gave wampum, but they also gave bales of beaver hides. So one other thing to think about is this notion that the dish is common, everyone can eat. But early on, what I want to tell you is what some of the scholars have said is that around this time when the fur trade became big, this agreement actually took on a different tone, and that basically everyone can hunt for themselves to eat. But once you started to change that and skin that and convert that hide and take that to a fur trade post and get a blanket or ammunition or a tin kettle or earrings or whatever, they said that was where you didn't have the right to do that. Any furs that were taken actually belonged to the people of that territory. So this is the part that's causing a bit of consternation amongst our people. and that people are getting a bit pushing back and forth over. So here, one of the things is this there's a great peace that's eventually held in 1701. But prior to that, here at Onondaga, which is the Onondaga is the central council fire of the Six Nations. Well, back then it was the Five Nations. And it's on the south, it's south of Lake Ontario. And anything that is affected at Onondaga is binding upon the rest of the four nations, five nations. So in 1700, a deputation of Anishinaabe went down there, and they said that the Haudenosaunee are the ones that wrote to the to Indian Affairs at Albany in June of 1700, prior to the Great Peace in 1701. This is another interesting meeting. And he says, we now must give you an account of what the Dowaugunes have said to at Onondaga. So Dowaugunes are either Mississauga people or the Odawa people. There is some dispute as to who they actually are, but they're Anishinaabe. Some of the Dowaugunes, having had a conference with our Indians at their hunting last winter, concluded to desert their habitation to come and live and settle upon the Lake of Cataraqui. This is Lake Ontario. And accordingly, they are come and settled there and have sent five of their people to Onondaga to treat, being sent from three nations who are very strong, having 16 castles, so meaning 16 villages. So three nations, so it's very evocative of what we would now call the three fires, but there's dispute whether it's a Ojibwe, Odawa, Potawatomi, or if it could be Mississaugi people as well, and Odawa and Ojibwe. So they say, we are come to acquaint you that we are settled on the north side of Lake Cataraqui, where we plant the tree of peace and open a path for all people, quite to Colère's house. Colère was the Dutch commander there, who actually used to be the main person to deal with in New York for the Haudenosaunee people. So bear in mind, these are Anishinaabe people speaking through the Haudenosaunee. Where we desire to have free liberty of trade, we make a firm league with ye five nations and Colère, and desire to be united in ye covenant chain, our hunting places to be one, and to boil in one kettle, eat out of one dish and with one spoon, and so be one. And because the path to Colère's house may be open and clear, do give a dressed elk skin to cover ye path to walk upon. The five nations answered them thus, we are glad to see you in our country and do accept of you to be our friends and allies, and do give you a belt of wampum as a token thereof, that there may be a perpetual peace and friendship between us and our young Indians to hunt together in all love and amity. Let this peace be firm and lasting, then shall we grow old and gray-headed together, else ye war will devour us both. So again, what's interesting there is the Anishinaabe go there and they say, we want to eat out of one dish. And they say, boil in one kettle and eat of one dish with one, and with our hunting places to be in common. So in this, it almost sounds like they come there with a wampum belt, but it actually doesn't say that. And then when the Haudenosaunee reply, they end up saying, we give you a wampum belt. But they actually don't describe that belt, and they don't actually say this belt is the dish belt. So that's a possibility where Peter Jones had said the first treaty was given to the Anishinaabe at the east end of Lake Ontario. So again, this is we're dealing with the oral tradition. So sometimes the dates definitely are never mentioned, but places are usually pretty accurate. So here, this is a scholar named Gilles Havard, who actually wrote a book in 2001 about the Great Peace of Montreal, the 300th anniversary. And he says, in short, the common bowl was probably one of the objectives of peace, but it was also especially one of its foundations. The purpose of sharing territories was to establish peace and avoid having hunters kill one another and set off new rounds of wars. The territorial question should not distract us from the fact that it was the peace settlement and not the sharing of hunting territories that was the major issue at 1701 conference. So people kind of dispute this, but this is one of the first documents that were signed by with Dodems by our people. And here you see this says Mark of the Lafourche, and that's the Odawa people of the Fort Nisswakaton, Odawa Nisswakaton people, and then the Gishkakon, Odawa here with the cattail, and then here Odawa Sinigo, the Odawa, the gray, the black squirrel Odawa. But here on the second row, Mark of the Mississaugi, that thunderbird or eagle, and then here Mark of the Umpqua, and that beaver, and then Mark of the Soto, and a crane. So again, keep those in mind as well. 1701, the Mississaugi eagle, the beaver, the Mark of the Umpqua beaver, and then the crane. So here, this is a fanciful depiction of that great piece. But this is what the governor, the French governor, had said, Governor Callier at 1701. This may also be a time when the belt was given. So he said, to all that were assembled, and this is the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, Miami, Sauk, Fox, thousands of people, a number of different nations. Having one and all placed your interests in my hands, I have you all live in tranquility. I therefore today ratify the peace agreement that we have made, as I am determined that there be no more talk of the attacks made during the war. So no more revenge, he's saying. And I gather up all your hatchets and all the other instruments of war, which I place with mine in a pit so deep that no one can take them back to disturb the tranquility that I have reestablished among my children. This is a Haudenosaunee metaphor where they made their great peace, great tree of peace, and they talk about actually turning it over and then burying all the weapons and then writing that tree over it, and then that pine tree then becomes a tree of peace as opposed to disposes of war. So he says, and I recommend to you when you meet to treat each other as brothers and make arrangements for the hunt together so that there will be no quarrels among you. I attach my words to the collars. The French call the wampum belts collars. English call them belts. French call them collars. I will give to each one of your nations so that the elders may have them carried out by their young people. I invite you all to smoke this calumet, which I will be the first to smoke, and to eat meat and broth that I have prepared for you, so that I have, like a good father, the satisfaction of seeing all my children united. So here, the important part that I wanted to show and stress to you is, again, that the governor gave a collar to each nation there. So it sounds like he could have given, he said there was 30 there. He may have given 30 belts out that had the dish with one spoon, or he could have just given plain wampum belts. But this is one of the things I'm trying to pursue further. But here, all these nations are understand or hear about the dish with one spoon of eating meat and broth out of one dish and sharing their lands in common. So that's kind of more to the West. If any of you are really interested, there's a book by an Abenaki woman named Lisa Brooks, and it's called The Common Pot. So I recommend you read that. It's a she talks about how the common pot was a metaphor on the East Coast. But one of the things I wanted to also, in discussing the origins of the dish and where this actually came about and how it was formulated and then how it actually manifested and then was transmitted. Here she has two maps here. One is the major maps of wampum and the fur trade from the southeast coast of Kitsitkiw, the St. Lawrence River. And then she has the map of the environs of Mohegan, showing the location of the Mohegan village and the territories of neighboring native communities from the wampum makers on the coast to the inland Wabanaki and Haudenosaunee. So she's basically saying through these maps is that it's the Mohegan people that actually, and Narragansett, that actually collected the wampum and made the beads. And then traded them, and then they were brought up to these roots, And then the Haudenosaunee people started to value these, and then they were the ones who started to make them into belts and strings. And then these were traded all throughout the Great Lakes. So that Migas, that we call Migas, which is wampum, the quahog shell and the whelk shell, the whelk is the white, quahog is the purple. These are materials that are traded for that are from the East Coast. They are sea-bearing saltwater organisms. So they aren't, they don't come from the Great Lakes. Here, this is a Mohegan chief. And in 1791, he was sent as on a mission to go west from his country. And he was sent by actually the Americans. But here she quotes him that Apamut was his name, Hendrik Apamut, and that's his likeness there on the left. Mohiganuk, our nativity, is the place where our ancestors agreed to kindle a fire and hang a kettle, whereof they and their children after them might dip out daily their refreshment. So she says, commenting on this, Brooke says, Algonquin identity was grounded in the place where you lived, the pot that fed you. Each village was a kettle unto itself and a part of the larger common pot that linked the communities together. So again, the metaphors, when you kindle a fire at a place, you're basically claiming it or staking a claim to it. And then when you hang a kettle there, you're doing so in peace, but it's also that that's you're indicating your domesticity there. And then that after everyone can dip and take from it. So you see that this too is actually a metaphor for that. So that's what Apamut had said. And that's the Mohegan people on the East Coast. And then he came all the way over to, actually went through what we now call Deshkan Zibing, London, Moravian town later as well. But this here is a Six Nations chief who tried to unite all the nations together after the American Revolution. And you see, he wears this great gorget. And some would say it's a great wampum, moon of wampum, perhaps. And that's why I chose this particular painting. There's many paintings of the chief, Joseph Brantine de Nega, but this one, he's actually wearing, it looks like a wampum belt across his shoulder, and then that great gorget. But he reportedly gave a wampum belt to the Anishinaabe, a friendship belt as well. But here in 1786, at Brownstown, which was the Council Fire of the Western Confederacy. Brownstown was south of Detroit, and it was the Huron were the uncles of the Western Confederacy, and the Odawa, Ojibwe, Potawatomi, Sauk, Fox, Menominee, and Miami, and all these were brothers or elder brothers, and the Shawnee were part of this as well. This is another part that we have to research further, this Western Confederacy. And the notion that the Central Council Fire, Brownstown, was where all these belts were kept because the uncles of the Confederacy, the Huron, were entrusted with keeping many of these belts. Anyway, Joseph Brant talked at that, and it was recorded. And he said, we have been told that such part of the country belongs to the Six Nations, but I'm of the opinion that the country belongs to the Confederated Indians in common. If we say such part of the country belongs to one nation and such a part to another, the union cannot subsist, and we cannot more effectively serve our enemies whose whole aim has been to divide us. Upwards of 100 years ago, a moon of wampum was placed in this country with four roads leading to the center for the convenience of the Indians from different quarters to come and settle to hunt here. A dish with one spoon was likewise put here with the moon of wampum. This shows that my sentiments respecting the lands are not new. So again, he's talking in 1786, but remember earlier what I read of that 1690 council at Michilimackinac. So it's almost, it is almost like 100 years since when they referred to hanging that moon of wampum over the straits between Lake Erie and Lake Huron. And that moon of wampum was to mark the boundaries there. So here he's bringing that back up because the Haudenosaunee people maintained that understanding. So we got a lot more to understand and to look at as we bring more of this out to our leadership and to our elders, and to see how many people actually recall these or have heard different ways that this was put. The other thing, of course, is what I mentioned at the beginning, is to look at how we actually enact and continue to practice this concept of the dish, having a common dish and setting aside. We call it setting aside a plate, but like I said, there's two ways of doing those feasts. And one is when the food is all laid out, then the one dish is just made from all that food. But then another way is everyone gets served, and then everyone takes a bit of their dish and they put it back into that one common dish for everyone. So here back, I'll return back to Peter Jones here, and he talks about this belt, and many people call it Yellowhead's belt. I don't like calling it Yellowhead's belt because he was just one of many that kept that belt. And when we start calling it belts after people, what often inevitably happens is people end up thinking it belongs to them or their family, but it actually belongs to the people. Anyway, he described this belt, and he said that this belt has a row of white wampum in the center from one end to the other. And then the other thing he said, it was three or four feet long, but that there are representations of wigwams every now and then, and a large round wampum tied nearly the middle of the belt with the representation of the sun in the center. And then, so the other thing there, when he talks about the discourse, so this is how we've made many renditions, and I'll show you in the next couple of slides. This is the current rendition of the belt that I had my buddy, Brian Charles Anishinaabe, Georgina Island, Jabal Mawa Anishinaabe, that this Brian Charles, I got him to make this belt for me, because it shows how this, to me, it mnemonically shows me how to recite that belt. So here are two different transcripts of that wampum belt, the talk on that wampum belt. So in 1840, there was a great council that took place at Lake Superior, and the fire should be kept burning at Sault Ste. Marie. And then Peter Jones wrote in 1861, that the council fire was at Sault Ste. Marie, but it had no emblem because there was the council was held. So that's the first symbol on the belt. And that the council fire at Manitoulin, a beautiful white fish who should watch the fire as long as the world stood. And then what Peter Jones adds in 1860 is that white fish signifies purity or a clean heart. All our hearts ought to be white towards each other. And in 1840, they also state that opposite an island of in Penetanguishene, opposite Penetanguishene, they placed a beaver to watch the fire. And then what Jones adds in 1860 is that beaver denotes wisdom, that all the actions of our grandfathers were done in wisdom. And then the fourth symbol on that belt, that at the narrows, a white reindeer was placed there who was committed to keep this wampum talk, and hung up the sun and dish placed with ladles around it, one of the ladles for the six nations, and the dish would never be empty. And then at this point, Yellowhead stated, but it is currently being emptied by the Caughnawagas. We'll return to that concept later. There's an emblem, and then Peter Jones adds that there are dish and ladles at the place to indicate abundance of game and food, but also that white reindeer represented superiority. And then here at the fifth one is that the river credit, a beautiful white-headed eagle was placed on a very tall pine tree in order to watch the council fires, and a dish was placed at the credit. So here the same thing he says, but that the eagle actually denotes watching and swiftness and to convey messages. The eagle was to watch all council fires of Ojibwe and Six Nations. And that if there were any trouble, the eagle was then to fly to that caribou, that white reindeer at the narrows, and then fly to that beaver at that island opposite Penetang, and then fly to that fish at the Manitoulin, and then fly to Sault Ste. Marie to deliver the news. So that's what the process was. I went to Washington, D.C. in maybe 2018, 2017. And this was the display they had, a dish with many spoons. So here is how we would think of that dish at the Narrows. And the Narrows, of course, is a place, Minjikining, the fish place of the fish weirs. And there was abundant food there. And the late Merle Sansbeedi, I was in, on a committee with her, and we were talking about a different curriculum to make. But she had told me, not just me, all of us in the meeting, that her father had said, or her grandfather had said, when the fish would go up there to spawn, pass through there, the clapping of their tails on the water, she said, her grandfather stopped her there, and he says, Nashke, Beka, Bizindan. And so he says, just wait, listen. And then that's what she said she could hear. And then he said to her, Misa Manda Bimadzuin. That is the sound of life. So anyway, that's this is just what it would look like and how it was depicted. But the other part that I want to emphasize to you all here too, these are the Six Nation chiefs, and this picture was taken in 1871. And remember, those council where that belt was renewed was in 1840. But the fellow standing there and pointing at one of the belts is John Smoke Johnson. And he was actually at that 1840 meeting. And when Yellowhead brought out that belt as the keeper of that belt, a member of the Caribou clan, the keeper of that belt, he read the belt, but he actually showed the Six Nations, and he was the one to say that this I received from your grandfathers. And then him and another chief by the name of Buck got up, and they said they talked about it. They recited the talk as they understood it, and then Yellowhead read it back. So the Six Nations knew that belt, and they renewed it. They knew of it. They knew the symbols and the talk, and they renewed it at that time. And this fellow John Smoke Johnson is a part of it. So what I've been trying to do lately, and Brian Charles has also been trying to do lately, is to get the Haudenosaunee to recognize that belt as well. Now, some of you may know that the Haudenosaunee, the Six Nations are putting through a court case called on the Nanfan Treaty, and to try and claim more territory in Southern Ontario. But I think one of the things that they seem to ignore is this belt that I call the Eternal Council Fires belt. So here, this is a map of this. And here, maybe you can't see it too well. I should have used thicker, I drew a crane, because that's the main, I learned this from Darlene Johnson. Mabanishnabe kwe neashina gaming jiba. Gnodamake kwe giyawe. This, my friend there, Darlene Johnson, she's from Cape Croker. She was a lawyer and then became a legal professor at the University of Toronto and then the University of British Columbia. Anyway, she was the one who showed me this speech that was recorded by Peter Jones and in the 1840 transcript. And then she was the one who had the insight that said that each animal that was placed at each council fire, she said, if you look at the treaties of those areas, you'll see that those are the main chiefs. So at Sault Ste., that's why we put a crane at Sault Ste. Marie. Although in the talk, it doesn't mention that. But they say a white fish. I don't think it means the species white fish at Manitoulin. It just means white, meaning purity. Like how we talk about a white bear or a white wolf or any of these white thunderbird. And then the beaver at that island opposite Penetanguishene. But historically, the Mi'kwa were further up at the French River at where the Georgian Bay curves into Lake Huron. Anyway, but remember that that great piece of Montreal that the Beaver Clan and the Eagle Clan signed it, as well as that fish. And then at the Narrows there, the Caribou Clan is placed there, and maybe you can see I drew. I'll have to refine this. And then at the River Credit, that bald-headed eagle is placed there. So if you look at any of these treaties at the Narrows for over 100 years, you see that the main clan is that Caribou. And if you look at any of the treaties around the Toronto area, that Eagle clan is the prominent one. So here, these three belts on the side, these are the progression of my thinking of this Eternal Council Fires belt. The first one I made with Ken Miracle, he's a Mohawk wampum belt maker. I brought him up to Chiging here, to Manitoulin, to make this. And then he said, we use diamonds for nations. And so I told him, well, okay. I said, but put in the, because the old man that I was going for teachings with always talked about the four directions. So I said, just put in the middle there an equilateral cross representative for four directions. So he said, yeah, okay, I'll do that. So that's why that belt has that cross in there. Anyway, I learned later from a Mohawk from Akwesasne, Darren Bonaparte, he says, when there's a cross in there, it means a fire. So I ended up kind of being right in a sense. So then after we knew, Brian Charles and I knew that the dish was placed at the Narrows and a dish was placed at the Credit. So the middle belt there, you see that it still has the diamonds and the five diamonds, and then the moon of wampum is tied there with the depiction of the sun. But the last two symbols, you'll see that dish is inside the diamond. Lastly, I said, I read the Peter Jones description, and he said there's representations of wigwams every now and then. And I was like, diamonds don't represent wigwams, but the hexagon could be looked at. If you think of it as an aerial view, then you could think of the hexagon as a representation of a wigwam. So that's why I ended up using these hexagons. This is the latest version that I got Brian Charles to make for me. So this is the evolution of my thinking. But here, this is the dish on the right, of course, is the dish that we all know. But here you see again in that hexagon is the dish at the Narrows. And here in this hexagon is the dish at the Credit. So that's what this represents: Sault Ste. Marie, Manitoulin Island, the island of Penetanguishene, the Narrows, and River Credit, and the moon of wampum at the hung up to represent the actions. The fifth mark represents the council fire, which was placed at the River Credit, where a beautiful white-headed eagle was placed upon a tall pine tree in order to watch the council fires and see if any ill winds blew upon the smoke of the council fire. A dish was placed at the Credit that the right of hunting on the north side of the lake was secured to the Ojibwees. And the Six Nations were not to hunt here, only when they come to smoke the pipe of peace with their Ojibwe brethren. So now this is the part that the people of the Credit now, the Mississaugas of Credit First Nation now are trying to exert, and the Haudenosaunee, the Six Nations people, are trying to, through that Nanfan legal agreement, court case, are trying to get usurp, or whatever you want to say, enforce, I should say. So this is where the disagreement is starting. But here again, I just want to show you again and remind you of that, according to our Anishinaabe history, the five nations, the Haudenosaunee, came up and they attacked us and they sent us north and west for a little while, but we regrouped and then we fought and we had significant battles and we chased them south, back south of the Great Lakes. That's our version of history. And then that's why we say, our people ended up at the Southern Ontario. Okay, I got 10 minutes. That our people ended up on the north shore of Lake Ontario and Lake Erie, and that we were the ones that by conquest took the place. And so you'll hear this terminology used, because in the Nanfan Treaty, that's what they're one of the Haudenosaunee assertions is in the Nanfan Treaty, is that we took that area by the sword, that they conquered it. So what they're ignoring is then by that time that we took it over. Anyway, that's going to be a place to for some a bit of dispute. So here, this is George Bodosh from Rice Lake. And then beside him is his fellow chief, John Crow. And their picture was taken when they went to meet the Prince of Wales in 1860. But they had expressed some grievances about the Haudenosaunee hunting in their territory as well. And then on the right is an author, a Anishinaabe author from Rice Lake as well, named George Copway. So you see here, Potash has that, is of the Crane clan. And then actually, Copway is of the Eagle clan. And then both of them report that their ancestor had come down, and that their ancestor, Copway says that his grandfather, great-grandfather, was a very intrepid man, because he ended up moving down in this area when there was still a real threat of Haudenosaunee attack. So he talks about that. So here, in council a number of times, Potash went to York, and he actually said in 1827, during the lifetime of Colonel Klaus, we were directed to communicate to him through the superintendent at this post any complaint or grievance under which we labored. Father, we therefore now state our brothers of Caughnawaga and of the Lake of Two Mountains, having exhausted their own hunting grounds, are encroaching on ours and destroying the beaver. And then in 1828, he went back again, and he said that he had come to ask his great father for some assistance. He also stated that the Grand River Indians were still making incursions on their hunting grounds. So again, although we had this dish with one spoon, the idea was that you could feed yourself, but you couldn't, the distinction is you couldn't take the hides of the beaver or the otter or whatever fur-bearing animal and take them. George Copway, Gagage Gabo, forever standing, ended up writing about this. And his father was a Crane clan chief. Oh, sorry, I had said he was Eagle clan. His father was Crane clan chief, and he was Crane clan as well. But he was born at the mouth of the Trent, Zagadajewanong. And then he states that the Mississaugas came from the north shore of Lake Huron, where current Mississaugi First Nation is. But he says that no one was allowed to hunt on another's land. And one of the stories he writes about in his autobiography, he says when he was a young man, him and his father and his uncle went to go visit their trap lines, their territory. And he stated where it was, like between Crow River and another river. I forget the exact river. But as they were going, this was the winter time, they saw some tracks. So they started following those tracks. And then they saw smoke billowing in the distance. So they went up to it. And when they got to that fire, they saw a number of men standing around. And those men actually had their furs already put in bales. And so he didn't recognize those people. They weren't of his band. So Copway says that his dad went there and they tried to talk to them, but they were Mohawk. They were Nottawa people. And so he said what his father did was, we sat on one side of the fire and they were on the other. Then his father crossed the fire, grabbed those bales of fur, and then went, put them on his side of the fire and sat back down. And both of them, they could not understand each other, both speak, nobody speaking a common language and neither speaking their other language. So he said, but the meaning was understood and the men left. My father kept those furs. So that was one of the things is that how this was done. Okay, somebody put in a Q&A. The book I mentioned was called The Common Pot by Lisa Brooks. Here, this notion actually went west and was at Manitoulin as well. But one of the things I want to read before I get to that is that in 1791, a Caughnawaga chief actually wrote to Indian Affairs and said, the King of France summoned the council of all the people on the continent, the Kaga from Kanawala, the Hurons, Algonquins, Nipissing, and he brought a big dish in which there was a piece of meat, broth, emquan, a knife, and he said to us, "My children, you are all brothers, all the same color, and by grace of God of the same religion, until this day you have been at war for your hunting territories. What I desire from you today is to you make peace forever. Here is a dish of meat, broth, and a mikwan, and a knife that you will take, paying attention not to hurt yourselves. Use all this without quarreling over it. The one who has the greater appetite will eat more, without the other having anything to complain about. My father, this parable signifies our hunting territories that the King of France placed in common. And he then placed the great fire in the village known as Kanawage, where the big dish was placed and that we have kept up until this day." So in 1791, it sounds like the dish with one spoon that was given by the French commanding officer, remember I showed Callier, that instead of each nation getting a wampum belt of a dish, it looks like he may have just given a wampum belt, but that the actual main wampum belt was given and entrusted to the people of Kanawage. Anyway, so then in 1845, the chiefs of Manitoulin write a letter to the chiefs of Ganasatage, and in Ojibwe they say, "Mi ge ga oje non dage ya, we bejat janda beje gedoge mam, manda gene nibin." So in the summer, one of your chiefs is reportedly coming here. Gishpin dash beja gwe. If he comes here, apche and dok chimin when dum gishpin we big gog is it, ewe kitche, a go wa dama, we wabin dama, gado naganana, getche pi ten dawak, misa eje bego senemina. So he says, "If he comes, I would be greatly pleased if he would bring with him that which you greatly desire me to see, our dish, which is highly valued. That's what I ask of you." And then in 1849, actually, a deputation of Mohawk chiefs from Kanasatage did come to Manitoulin, and they brought 5 wampum belts, but the Jesuit didn't record what those belts looked like, and he didn't actually say it was a dish with one spoon. Anyway, so here, I got 2 minutes. So he says here, this after the 1862 treaty was signed on Manitoulin, the Wequemcong people did not sign that, and in fact, they forcibly evicted people from their community who were amenable to that treaty. And so they had another council in 1864 at Mantuanik, and the chief Wakagijik was the one who said this to the chief on the left here is Mijak Konage, and he signed that treaty of 1862 and 1850. Anyway, Wakagijik says, when the land you have ceded shall have been divided among yourselves and the white settlers, what land will your children have? My friends, we want to eat out of one dish, as it were. We do not wish to break a part of it to give away. All of us who met together at Michiguernong, that's Chiging here, 3 years ago and held a grand council there, agreed that we should eat out of one dish. We feel convinced that the Indians would be better off if they kept the island for themselves than if they surrendered a part of it. Chief Wakagijik, 1864. So at Manitoulin, we also had this, carried that tradition of the dish. And here, this is the last slide. I just read a book by Amy Kraft, and it's called Breathing Life into the Stone Fort Treaty, which is also called Treaty One. And she recorded and worked with a number of elders there. But Elder Victor Cushane talked about what the treaty meant, and he says, this is what Victor Cushane said out by Manitoba area. I think he's from Saugeen First Nation out of Manitoba, Fort Alec. One old man, much older than me, said his grandfather told him about the treaty and how it was supposed to work. He said it is like a plate and the resources were on that plate. The white man was invited to come and eat from that plate together with the Anishinaabe. This is how he understood the treaty. They never gave up anything. So again, if we think of the plate or the dish or the bowl, and it has so many ladles around it, or if it just has one ladle, that's the other thing to keep in mind. When it's dish with one spoon, then you have to take time and care, take turns with one dish, I mean one spoon. But if you have a lot of ladles around there, then many people come as well. So my time's up. I see our friend here, the MC, Scott. So, and that's the actual end of my slide. Miigwech gee bizin de mek kene enchiek ni jinishnabe kanishnabe duk mihinwa gima gimaak nagan zirik getse pichi jikage mihinwa nichken duk. Thank you all, leaders, chiefs, elders, and my fellow Anishinaabe. Thank you for listening to me again.
Miigwech Allen, I was just reading someone that put something in the chat. The teaching of the dish with spoon is better filling, and now to digest the information. one very, very quick question, Allen. Because I love these teachings of the Wampum Belt and the meaning and the spirit behind them. How can we use some of the teachings that you've shared with us today in today's setting? So how is it the dish with one spoon? How can we use that to improve working relationships today?
One of the things that I mentioned, we, in a sense, we're already doing this when we have our community feasts, but usually that spirit plate that people set aside is one that's done for the ancestors sometimes, like for the feed the spirits. But the other thing is when you do, there's that different feast that I was talking about, the clan feast, and that's when actually, there's the two ways of actually making that. One, you make one little separate dish for them, but the other one is when everyone puts a bit from their own dish into one pot. So you're literally sharing back kind of thing. So we think of this dish with one spoon as the land. We've taken from the land, all of us, and we're giving, of course, many of us now also know that we're giving thanks when we do that. And that's part of the teaching. What I forgot to mention as well is that Rick Hill, Tuscarora of the Six Nations, he does a good job, great job on this dish with one spoon from the Haudenosaunee perspective. But his basic teaching is that don't break the dish, don't empty the dish, keep the dish clean, and make sure there's enough for everybody else. And that's the thing with the land, that he looks at it through an environmental ethic lens, that we care for that land, that we don't do anything destructive to it, and that we try not to dirty it or pollute it, and that means the land. And then also that we make sure that everyone else has something to it. And well, in a sense, this teaching is... What they say, geigo zagzik ke, don't be stingy. And it's the other thing is to share. So actually what I wanted to say is that Bob Goulet invited myself and Brian Charles, but he's also got Rick Hill there and Diane Longboat to actually talk about renewing these belts. And they invited a deputation to go down to Onondaga at some point. But it's at the very preliminary stages. One of the things is that what we have to do is to actually start to think about those council fires, where they were ignited on that eternal council fire belt. And what I had mentioned in previous presentations is that what I would like to see is that as Anishinaabe people, we do see that we have council fires at the Sioux, but and then to actually move that council fire to Manitoulin, and then to the island opposite Penetanguishene Bay, and then to the Narrows, and then to the Credit. So when we do that and deliberately keep that belt in mind when we're doing that, and then that's when we would be renewing it, but also to extend that wampum belt, to renew that wampum belt with the Haudenosaunee, and then also to take our pipes there, have the pipe carriers, the people who are pipe carriers to take that to the Haudenosaunee as well, because that's how it was, as I tried to share, how in the past our ancestors did that. When they went to Onondaga, that deputation took that pipe there. And then when the Haudenosaunee came up to Michilimackinac, the Odawa chief sent pipes and wampum and bales of beaver down to Onondaga as well. So that's the formulation of what we can do now.
It's the concept is so simple and perfect at the same time. And it's like, why aren't we teaching this? Sorry, you are. I'm saying globally, it's so simple. We make things overly complex when it's so simple. We have, I'm excited. We have Stitch has his hand up. Stitch, if you could unmute and ask your question, this is going to be exciting. Throwing caution to the wind.
Yeah. You're exposing yourself.
Stitch, it's all yours. Just need you to unmute. Well, maybe not.
Oh, he chickened out. That's my buddy. Well, everybody's buddy.
I know. Okay, well, we'll come back.
That's the other thing, I guess. Actually, what I had, Sam Manitoba, who works for the Robinson Huron Treaty, Wawinamagewin organization, he was asking me to do some kind of workshop. But I said, actually, what you should do is get people who are like Stitch, who are actually out on the land harvesting and feeding people, as well as I really like what Perry McLeod Shawagijik does as well. Hunts a moose and then takes it to North Bay Friendship Center and other areas so that people in the urban areas, but also that in shelters, actually get to feed on game, moose and fish. So, and I see that Stitch does that and he wants to teach people that as well. That's the other part that I guess I should say is that I wanted the people that actually go out there and then share that food and then have these hunt camps. That's part of it as well, is looking at the land as the dish and actually going there, treating it as one dish and then feeding each other.
Yeah. Well, Chi-Miigwech, Alan, and if you were sticking around, that's fantastic. And hopefully we'll get Stitch back on. And he is doing amazing work with youth and some of the things that he's working on. So excited to hear from him. But let's move on to our next group. So Chi-Miigwech, Alan.
Okay.
Just a touch behind, but I'm sure Cynthia will help us out here. Climate change and food security presentation. I'd like to welcome Westaway Law Group for a presentation on climate change and food security. Introducing Cynthia Westaway. Must be a big deal, because if it's the Westaway Law Group and your last name is Westaway, you must be a big deal then. So Cynthia, will you introduce Brett or?
Sure.
Okay. I'll hand it over to you now, Cynthia. Thank you for being here.
Thanks very much. The big deal is just that we're very busy, which is good. We have a lot of important issues related to sustainability and environment and climate change to support the leadership and to support our clients across Canada. So we were asked to be part of a project with the Anishinaabeg Nation. We've been very fortunate and blessed to do some of this traditional teachings and traditional knowledge work across Canada, in the West, in Saskatchewan and Manitoba, most recently, also with the Dene in the North. And we've worked several years with the Anishinaabeg Nation on some of their bigger cases, going to the Supreme Court and making sure that, they spoke up on big issues like climate change. So we were asked to start to support this project, which is around food security and how the impacts of climate change on our nations here. So I've been doing this with my colleague Brett Campo, who will do the presentation today, and I'll jump in and out a little bit. Brett is a lawyer that's practiced out in that's trained and practiced and done expert work mostly related to the environment and to lands in BC in special courses in Montreal. He was a caribou biologist before he was foolish enough to go back to law school. So Westaway Law is very grateful to have Brett. And so I'll let him introduce himself, but we'll do this presentation and you can feel free to put up your hand or just, you know, clear your throat when you want to jump in and share something important. You don't need to wait to the end when you might forget it. So please feel free to dialogue with us. And then we'll try to leave some time to talk about the project at the end as well. Okay. So with that, if there's no comment yet, I'll turn it over to you, Brett, to introduce yourself.
Okay, excellent. Thank you so much, Cynthia. Can everyone hear me okay?
Well, thanks.
Okay, excellent. So to begin, I'd like to thank everybody, of course, for the honor of being able to present today. I had the privilege of listening to a number of the presentations yesterday, and I think it's all very important work, and delighted to be able to make my own small contribution by helping out with this important food security study. So to begin, I'd like to give a little bit of an overview of the topics that we will cover in our presentation today. So you'll see here that we'll start by introducing you all to the project and its key components. There are three. We began with a literature review of existing Anishinaabeg Nation knowledge on climate change and food security. And then we looked at doing interviews and surveys with knowledge holders from the different Anishinaabeg Nation regions to pull out some of the key themes relating to climate change impacts on food security. And finally, as a final component of this project, we're delivering presentations like this one and drafting final reports that we hope may be distributed to the different Anishinaabeg Nation members to help help them with climate change adaptation and resilience building. For the second part of this presentation, we'll give a bit of an overview of climate change generally and its different food security impacts, and we'll refer specifically to the issue of cumulative impacts. And I'll turn to Cynthia to discuss some of the key legal developments that have been happening lately, like the important Blueberry River case out in British Columbia. Thirdly, we'll go over some of the common themes that we identified through our literature review among the different Ontario First Nations for the key impacts on food security that we're seeing. These include things like impacts on birds, animals, and insects, on wildlife generally, impacts on water and fish, impacts on the weather, and impacts on culture. These are things that we're seeing across Ontario. Fourthly, we'll take more of a regional approach to look at differences within the four, within and among the four Anishinaabeg Nation regions, and we'll pull out some of the key regional differences that we identified so far. And I'll turn again to Cynthia for some of our key conclusions from the project so far. We'll offer our ideas for some strategies that could help to address impacts on food security and some of our preliminary recommendations. So to begin, so here is a map that I'm sure everyone is a little bit familiar with, showing the four different Anishinaabeg Nation regions. Of course, this is a huge part of Ontario covering many different climate and ecosystem regimes. So there's a lot of diversity here. And we found that there's a lot of diversity between the different member communities that have done work to identify climate change impacts already. So in this project, we want to identify some of those key differences in order to help inform adaptation and resilience building in each region. And I list those three key project components again. So in order to build resilience in the First Nation member communities and to help adapt to climate change, we know it is important to assess the vulnerability of the different member First Nations to the different climate change impacts that they are experiencing. And this can be done partly by conducting what we refer to as vulnerability assessments. We see that many First Nations across the country are already beginning this type of work. And it's very helpful to gather information about the impacts and the different concerns and priorities of the member First Nations of Anishinaabeg Nation. In this project, we're looking at doing a region-specific vulnerability assessment, because this is a very useful tool to identify how the different regions are expected to both be most impacted by climate change. And it's helpful to inform strategies for adaptation and resilience building. And finally, we know that these region-specific approaches to vulnerability assessments are very helpful to identify and target your adaptation planning to the most vulnerable areas within Anishinaabeg Nation, and to target those key concerns of the different member communities. So I'll just give it more information about that first component of our project. We have largely completed our literature review, where we went and looked at different research articles, studies, and reports through library databases and through internet searches to identify some of the common themes and regional differences among the different Anishinaabeg Nation member communities. And I list some of the key sources that we have identified and reviewed in a couple of bullets there for you. There were a number of them, and there's a huge amount of information out there, but a lot of it is First Nation specific and doesn't necessarily adopt a regional approach. So for us, a lot of the work was going and looking at these specific studies that examine knowledge from specific First Nations, and then trying to extrapolate that to understand the regional differences that exist. We are continuing to conduct interviews and surveys in collaboration with our Anishinaabeg Nation partners. We're working very closely with Lorianne Whitaker and Lane Moreau at the Anishinaabeg Nation Lands and Resources Department, helping to support them in their doing of interviews and conducting surveys to hear directly from Anishinaabeg Nation members. To date, we understand that at least three interviews have already been conducted with knowledge holders in the different communities. We have one from a Northern Superior Region elder from Pick River First Nation, one from Garden River First Nation in the Lake Huron region, and another from the Lake Huron region from a member of the Wunapete First Nation. We're also in the process of delivering surveys. We have a link here that we encourage any Anishinaabeg Nation members to visit, and you can fill out this survey to help contribute to this project, and we'll be able to integrate your survey responses into our final report. I understand that the slides will be made available on the Lands and Resources Project website later this week, and so we encourage you to visit that website, and you could click on this link to visit the survey page. So the final component of the project was us delivering a presentation like this one today, and also completing a final report, which will synthesize the results from our literature review and from the different surveys and interviews that will be conducted. We'll prepare this report and distribute it to the Anishinaabeg Nation leadership, and then perhaps we'll deliver summary reports or other products to each of the different member First Nations, or provide reports that are tailored to each of the specific Anishinaabeg Nation regions. Okay, so I'll now begin with the second component of our presentation. We'll provide a bit of an overview of climate change and food security impacts generally. You see in this map here showing changes in mean annual temperature across Canada over the last several decades, that there has been an increase of at least a couple of degrees Celsius in average temperatures across the country, with more pronounced warming in the more northern parts of the country. We know that climate change is already having significant impacts on lands and waters across Canada, and that is having important consequences on food security. We also know that these climate change impacts will combine with those from other human activities, things like resource development, including forestry, mining, hydroelectric development, oil and gas development. These impacts will all combine to result in what's referred to as cumulative impacts or cumulative effects on the environment. Some of these key impacts we know will include impacts on plants and wildlife, which will in turn impact the ability of First Nations people to harvest wild foods, impacting food security. And we also know that climate change and cumulative impacts will affect the predictability of the weather and the environment, which will affect the ability to hunt and harvest, engage in traditional activities on the land. I show this slide here to describe a little bit more what you mean by cumulative impacts. This is a map here simply from Google Earth showing the greater Sudbury area, which as we know has experienced considerable development over the last several decades. You can see, of course, the urban development in the greater Sudbury area, but we also have images here of the tailing ponds associated with mining development, which have had a lasting impact on the environment, and agricultural development to the north of the urban development towards Lake Wanapate in the top right corner of that image. So these cumulative impacts from various development activities we know contribute to the effects of climate change and thus exacerbate the effects on food security. Cumulative impacts can refer to all the combined impacts of different activities which all have disturbance effects on the landscape. So here we can include things like climate change, wildfires and pest infestations, resource development, linear disturbances, so things like roads and hydro lines, as well as agriculture and urban expansion. And all these impacts will combine to harm wildlife and their habitat, which will affect food security. I'll turn now back to Cynthia for a couple of slides to discuss some of those key legal developments that we mentioned relating to cumulative effects and climate change. These are having important consequences for how the Crown engages with First Nations on climate change management.
Okay, thanks, Brett. Yeah, we're very focused in the legal and strategy world on getting governments, the Crown in Ontario and Canada and the courts, to understand the impact of cumulative impacts. Because when you go and do one legal case on the impact of a tailings pond, or a separate legal case on the impact of mining or forestry and clear cutting, the impacts on the waters of herbicide spraying, each of those cases is very expensive. And of course, the First Nations are living in that environment and impacted by all of it. So how can we change the law and change the policies of the Crown to better recognize that they have to have tools to look at it more globally and the impact in the entire region? So one of the cases that we're bringing right now for three First Nations are leading it up near Timmins, Chapleau Cree and Mississinabe Cree and Brunswick House is a forestry cumulative impacts case. And so that's something to watch. And it's a treaty case. It's that the treaty provides for wellness and that the Crown must have a plan to assess cumulative impacts. They can't just have legislation and regulations that don't provide results, are not impacting climate change, are not protecting the lands and waters. You know, we're insisting on results. The good news is this case, Blueberry River, that came out of BC, Yahe versus BC, very recently, where the court found that the province had infringed their Treaty 8 obligations and the rights of the First Nation, because the cumulative impact diminished their capacity to exercise their rights. It's common sense, but we finally have a court that is telling the Crown that they have to pay attention to these impacts in the whole region because they are significantly impacting First Nations to a greater extent. So this is really important. You're gonna see a lot of action like this across Canada now. BC jumped in, rolled up their sleeves, which I will give them some credit for, and didn't appeal the decision. Instead, they said, you know what, we have a common goal. We also need to protect these lands from cumulative impacts and the effects of climate change. So they have set aside an agreement to provide $65 million in trying to heal the damage that's already been done by the cumulative impacts in that region. That region has a lot of mining impacts. They have a lot of oil and gas, and they've got this fund to protect the indigenous way of life, and they've set up a, a table. I know that $35 million is available at the beginning to negotiate solutions. So instead of going to court on 8 different cases, which costs everybody money and brings no results, you get a declaratory remedy, you might get some damages. So far in Canada, we haven't seen damages for cumulative effects. They're going to sit down. So clearly that has to happen in Ontario. Clearly the treaty nations need to be respected and listened to and heard on things like herbicide spraying and cumulative impacts. So keep an eye on our forestry case. It'll be filed shortly. And hopefully many of the Ontario nations will join in as interveners and support this important case. Next one. But BC agreed to provide the $35 million upfront to do the healing and to help the First Nations exercise their stewardship role. That's the other problem. We've had, you know, 4 fisheries officers looking at 3 provinces. Instead of the people who are there and can be the proper stewards and can report and can monitor what's happening on the lands. So we really want a stewardship role in the BC case and certainly here in Ontario for monitoring the rivers, the streams, habitat, looking at moose habitat, looking at the waters and the all furry animals. And we want to have restoration activities. How are we going to repair the damage that's already been done? The earth can heal itself, but it needs support and needs a real plan. And somebody has to be looking at the big picture. It can't be piecemeal. So the second $30 million fund in Blueberry River was to protect the Indigenous way of life. This is we're losing, as Brett will tell you in the study he's already started with the team at the Anishinaabeg Nation. You know, we're losing language, culture, opportunities to train youth. All of those things are at risk. So this plan is to try to expand the capacity for the local communities to be part of that solution and really create a collaborative effort. So we'll be watching it closely.
Okay, thank you so much, Cynthia. I'd like to...
We'll pause, Brett. Anybody have any questions or comments on the legal actions or the legal case of Blueberry River? Okay, well...
Yeah, I don't see any... there's nothing in our chat or Q&As or raised hands, so...
Okay, great. So we'll talk at the end then. Thanks.
Okay, excellent. Okay, so on this slide, I'm presenting the 4 different common themes that we identified in our literature review among the different Ontario First Nations for how climate change is impacting their food security or food sovereignty. The first was impacts on birds, animals, and insects, so on wildlife generally. The second was on impacts on water and fish. The third, impacts on weather. And the fourth, impacts on culture. For the first theme, we saw from the studies that we have reviewed that there are both impacts on wildlife habitat and impacts on wildlife health that are of concern for food security. For wildlife habitat, we see that there is evidence of an increased frequency or severity of forest fires and pest infestations, which will, of course, have important impacts on the boreal forest environment and the wildlife that live there. We also see important changes in the average temperature and precipitation across Ontario, and that has led to changes in the timing of seasonal events, which of course affect the quality of wildlife habitat and their migration or other behaviors, which are often dependent on seasonal timing. So these different changes to habitat related to climate change have resulted in a decrease in habitat quality in many cases, and habitat fragmentation, especially when we view climate change impacts in combination with those other cumulative effects from activities like forestry and mining. These different changes to wildlife habitat, of course, make the land less suitable in many cases for hunting and trapping, which reduces food security. For the impacts on wildlife health, we have seen increased competition from different non-native species, and we had a great presentation yesterday from the Invasive Species Center that discussed a lot of these challenges in detail relating to the expansion of the range of various non-native species, including many important pest species that could cause great damage to boreal forest ecosystems, for example. you also see a greater risk of disease spreading among wildlife populations. And this is connected to climate change, partly because we see with warming temperatures, many different pests or vectors for disease are able to expand their range northwards into new environments. And we also see those changes in seasonal timing for the different types of wildlife. Often their behaviors for beaver, for example, are dependent on timing of freeze up or thaw, different environmental indicators, which if they change will affect the ability of wildlife to do what they do. So there are challenges there related to changes in seasonal timing. And all of these things, if they cause a decrease in the health of wildlife, that of course will mean that fewer healthy animals are available for hunting or trapping, and that will in turn reduce food security.
Mm-hmm. Brad, I'll just add that in our Supreme Court case on climate change recently, we had really strong evidence from the leadership on Manitoulin and also near Nipissing area that there were increased snakes, for example, in the water, that the water warming and the changed seasons, and that the rabbits were not changing color at the same time. And this kind of evidence before the Supreme Court was very influential, and the court ended up citing tribal chair Patsy Corbière's evidence as well as Chief Harris' evidence at the time. So I think it was pretty important for the Supreme Court to know exactly what's happening and have some concrete examples on the impacts for our First Nations. So I thought I'd just mention that.
Thank you. On to now our second key theme that we identified, the impacts on water and fish. We see in this theme both impacts on water quality and impacts on fish health. For water quality, we have reviewed studies that document knowledge about increases in average water temperature and how this has affected oxygen levels in water bodies to the detriment of many cold water fish species, which rely on cold waters and high oxygen levels for quality habitat. Now, we've also seen changes in seasonal timing for freeze up and snow melt, which affects water flow and the quality of water that way. And there's also evidence of increased erosion, again, associated with cumulative impacts from land clearing activities and climate change too, through increases in severe weather and flooding, for example. And this increased erosion contributes to an increase in sediment and contaminants in water bodies, which of course will decrease water quality. So these things with a reduced water quality has impacts on the availability of good drinking water. We heard yesterday from the Anishinaabeg Nation Advisory Council panel about how it wasn't really possible or people didn't feel good about drinking water from the water bodies, unlike they did in the past. So there have been these impacts on the quality of water for drinking, for recreation purposes, and as fish habitat. So also for fish health, we've seen evidence of increases in competition from non-native species, again, which we've seen from our presentation yesterday. We know of species like zebra mussels that are moving into different lakes in Ontario. There are various other aquatic non-native species, invasive species that are moving in and disrupting the natural balance that existed in those ecosystems. We are also seeing those an increase in the risk of diseases spreading among fish populations and changes in the habitat and seasonal timing for activities like spawning. So these different impacts have reduced fish health in many cases. That has meant that there are fewer healthy fish available for consumption for fishing among Anishinaabeg Nation members. And this has led to a reduction in food security among many communities. The third common theme that we identified was impacts on weather. And in this category, we discussed things like observed changes in the weather, temperature and precipitation and the like, and more generally impacts on the relationship between Anishinaabeg Nation people and the land. For the changes in weather, we see more frequent hot days in the summer, longer summers, a later onset of the winter cold, which has impacts on ice formation on different water bodies, and also earlier springs and snowmelt in many cases. And more generally, we see rough winds and increases in the frequency of severe weather. All this taken together with these observed changes in weather, we also see that weather is becoming more difficult to predict. And this affects the ability of harvesters to go out on the land safely. For impacts on the relationship with the land, we see that with these changes in weather, there is a loss of ice fishing opportunities and the use of ice roads related to changes in freeze up and thaw. There is evidence of creeks drying up and more frequent or severe flooding occurring in communities. And there are also those changes in seasonal cycles that we've observed, which affect the behavior of different plants and animals. One of our interview participants referred to confusion among animals. For instance, I believe the interviewee mentioned beaver in this example, and how with changes in the timing of freeze-up, that of course changed the behavior of beavers, so they weren't able necessarily to respond to changes in environment as well as they might have under more ordinary climate circumstances. So these climate changes are impacting the ability of animals too to predict their environment, and that affects the ability of Anishinaabeg Nation members to harvest effectively.
Brett, one of our participants also put up, I noticed in the chat group, that then when they were younger, there were parasites, of course, that you would find in larger fish. And I think now what I'm seeing from the note is that they're found in all sizes of fish, which is also a big change.
Absolutely. So similar to the changes in invasive species, we're also seeing pests and different parasites becoming more prevalent in Ontario. And I believe a lot of that would be associated with climate change because it's allowing these different parasites and disease vectors to expand their range. Mm-hmm. So the fourth and final category or a key theme that we identified was impacts on culture. And we know for Anishinaabeg Nation people that the concept of living a good life or living well in relationship with all of creation is central to Anishinaabeg Nation ways of being and Anishinaabeg Nation cultures. It is important among Anishinaabeg Nation people to recognize and really respect that kinship relationship that exists between humans and other creatures, other parts of the natural world. And any loss of that interconnectedness that might come from climate change and changes in the environment could eventually lead to a loss of Anishinaabeg Nation identity and culture. But of course, culture is also a very important force to build resilience and adapt to change. We know that Anishinaabeg Nation and member communities have lived in harmony with the environment since time immemorial. So there's already great resilience there and a great understanding of the environment that can be leveraged to respond to these different changes in climate that we're seeing. However, with the changing climate, there are, and we've heard this from a number of the different studies that we reviewed and some of the different interviewees, we know there are fewer opportunities to participate in traditional practices and for youth to learn their culture. It might not be as easy to go out on the land and practice those traditional harvesting activities as it once was. And this can be a threat to the continuity of some traditions or teachings. But in any event, it is important to maintain and reinforce all those on the land practices, traditions, and relationships to land that are so important to Anishinaabeg Nation culture. And this is so despite the changing environment. We know, again, that the Anishinaabeg Nation people have been resilient in the face of change in the past, having dealt with it for millennia. So it's important to leverage this to build resilience to the future changes that we're likely to experience. On to now the fourth component of our presentation, examining the key regional differences that exist within Anishinaabeg Nation. I'll begin with the Northern Superior region. We know because climate change is having such important impacts in the northern parts of the globe that the Northern Superior region and Northern First Nations are more likely to experience significant climate change impacts. Among the different First Nations in this region, we have seen increases in temperatures and impacts on ice as a travel platform for harvesting activities, ice fishing activities, and the use of winter roads. We saw in one study from Knowledge Keepers in Fort William First Nation that there have been a number of changes related to water and waterways, plants, trees, and forests, the air and winds, the distribution and well-being of wildlife, and seasonality. And one of the elders that participated in an interview noted that we cannot follow our teachings and use the whole animal anymore because organs seem to be contaminated. We heard from some of our elder guests on the Anishinaabeg Nation Advisory Council yesterday that there have been reports of contamination in wildlife that has been harvested, and this is likely to be connected to climate change. One Fort William First Nation elder noted that climate change makes the land ill and us ill. For the Lake Huron region, we also see significant changes in climates like the Northern Superior region. And there are also very important mining and forestry development activities that exacerbate the impacts of climate change. One elder from Wanapete First Nation noted that there were changes in the size and abundance of blueberries and that raspberries no longer look as healthy. So this could, of course, be related to climate change as well as some of the impacts of the different development activities in the region. One elder from Garden River First Nation noted that everything seems to be moving further north and that this is going to change their ability to harvest different animal species. They also noted that the ice is thinner than it used to be, and that this has made it more difficult to harvest animals like beaver and muskrat. Finally, I have a quote here from one of our Garden River First Nation interview participants. They noted that with less plant, fish, and wildlife species around to learn their traditions, that there are less opportunities for youth to learn and build meaningful relationships with the land. On to now our two southern regions within Anishinaabeg Nation. First, the southeast region. We've seen evidence in the different studies we've reviewed that the food systems in this region are already being impacted by urban growth, being more closely located to a number of relatively large urban centers. Curve Lake First Nation has noticed a loss of fishing and ice roads associated with the warming temperatures we're seeing with climate change. But as a way to help build resilience against these changes, there are plans in this community to enhance the harvest of wild rice. Among members of the Chippewa of Georgina Island First Nation, they have noticed changes in the color and temperature of Lake Simcoe, that creeks in the area had dried up, that there are fewer cold water fish, and this, of course, has important consequences for food security because of the ability to harvest fresh fish. They also noticed that some species of birds were gone, that timing of seasons had changed, and that there was now what was referred to as poor ice quality and less snow in the region, along with rougher winds, which we mentioned previously. And similar to what one of our elder guests mentioned yesterday, there were reports of rashes after swimming in the lake, that the water isn't of the same quality that it once was.
On that note, Brett, one of our participants is sharing in the chat that there are more algae blooms as well, and they last longer than before. So that's also interesting. We can feed into our study.
Okay, thanks so much for that comment. Yes, that would be one of the many, one of the probably main factors contributing to the decrease in water quality in these areas.
Just while we're paused, does anybody else have anything they wanted to share on some things that they've noticed that Brett may not have mentioned yet? There's a few more slides, but. Okay, we'll keep going. Just click your video on if you want to chat with us. Go ahead.
Okay, yes, please. So finally, now on to our fourth and final region, the Southwest region. We heard from the Regional Deputy Grand Council Chief yesterday that this region, being more urban and more exposed to industrial activity, has dealt with a lot of cumulative impacts over the last several decades, which are now exacerbating the impacts of climate change. We heard the story of the village of Oil Springs, for example, the earliest oil gusher in Canada, and we heard about the impacts associated with oil and gas development related to that resource in this region of Anishinaabeg Nation. All these different industrial development activities have made it unsafe to rely on traditional food, according to some Anishinaabeg Nation members. We see, for example, that because of this industrial pollution, that people are more reluctant to eat fish from their waterways in their traditional territories, and that there's a concern about eating other animals like rabbits because of the fear of contaminants associated with industrial activity. And so these things are especially important here in this Southwest region because of the significant development that has occurred and the cumulative impacts associated with those developments. One member of a First Nation in this region noted that they would really like to be able to practice their culture and traditions, but climate change, and I'm sure they would agree, the cumulative impacts are becoming an increasingly important issue.
And I'll just mention that we do some work with in this area with Munsee, Delaware, and some of the other First Nations. And, you know, they really are living with the odors and the impacts in the water potentially of Toronto's garbage. There's a landfill that's been put not far from the First Nations. And so that's something that has not been, we feel, properly monitored. And so there's a real push to work with and get an agreement with Toronto and the operators of the landfill to make sure that there's better monitoring for people who have wells and for the water systems. The Thames is a beautiful river system running right through the reserves there. But as well, there's a new project which is perhaps more positive in that they're trying to trap the methane gas that naturally escapes in a landfill and before it causes more odor and damage to people in the region, to use it as some kind of renewable natural gas that will instead support the communities and also take the pollution out of the air and use some of the methane to create something that's more safe and renewable. So the First Nations in that region are very interested in that kind of initiative. And again, talk about developing resilience. You know, what do you do when you've got odors from a landfill? So that's an interesting example.
Thank you, Cynthia. So this is our last slide of this section, where we'll offer some of our key findings relating to the regional differences that exist between the four Anishinaabeg Nation regions. We found that in the southern regions, there is a greater concern about how industrial pollution is exacerbating the negative effects of climate change. In the northern regions, in contrast, there is more of a concern about the impacts of resource development activities like forestry and mining and the cumulative impacts associated with those. Also in the northern regions and in the different island-based communities, there's a concern about the deterioration of waterways and ice road conditions with climate warming, as this is likely to make winter food and fuel transport and accessing the land for harvesting activities more difficult. In the southern regions, we see that there is a greater potential for agricultural projects as a form of adaptation, for example. However, we also see evidence of the contamination concerns. So it could be a challenge to develop agriculture unless there are efforts to really address those contamination concerns. In the northern regions, there is perhaps a greater potential to implement on-the-land harvesting programs, support for traditional harvesters and youth to engage in traditional activities because of the relatively unfragmented condition of the natural environment. So these northern regions are, of course, more distant from the larger urban centers and development activities in the south. So there is perhaps a greater potential to really revitalize and re-engage in all those important traditional activities that have sustained those communities for generations. In the southern regions, we note that because they are often more urbanized and there are many First Nation members that live in urban settings, there could be a greater need for food programs that are tailored to the needs of urban First Nation people. So now that we are onto our final concluding section, and I think I can turn to Cynthia perhaps to summarize our findings so far. Sorry, Cynthia, you're on mute.
Sorry, thank you. Yeah, I'm reading some of these great comments too that Crystal Madabi has shared that from Robert that our maple sap has been running really well here, and that's a good thing to focus on, and it seems hopefully it'll stay that way. It's running early a little bit. That's interesting. So that may be both a blessing and something difficult to deal with as well. And then there's a question here on what program there may be for harvesters to assist them in this context. So I think we can address that in some of our conclusions. Again, you know, we don't want to just leave this study and this learning completely depressed because of all the changes that are happening. There will be change. But again, if anybody can help us get through change, it's our elders. It's the language and the culture that have been developed for centuries. So it's just a matter, I think, of paying a different kind of attention to this with this knowledge that we have and we're gaining from our elders and from the scientific research and from the case law and the new court cases. So again, maintaining those relationships, there will need to be more attention from our lands advisors and our leadership on how to help bring more funding to the harvesters. I know in our flooding cases in the West, for example, we've negotiated lots of harvesters support to deal with people who can't net when there's flooding concerns and things like that. So same thing with getting out on the land. You know, there are going to be more dangers related to high winds and climate change. So maybe we're going to put some more money into cell phone towers for safety for our harvesters. Things like that are always got to be in the front of our mind. And so I guess just using those teachings that we've always used. And maybe the next slide, Brett. Or maybe I missed one. Okay, there. So some of the strategies better understand the impacts. So again, this really points to monitoring. So when we're negotiating with governments, when we're talking to forestry, MNRF or any of the people we have to work with all the time, making sure that there is money and attention and leadership from the First Nation on monitoring. So we are sharing that information and making sure that there are no gaps in our regions. So again, getting a renewed focus on our capacity to monitor and to do our own assessments of what's happening on the land. I know that Anishinaabeg Nation has been developing tools related to environmental assessments for First Nations by First Nations. Promoting adaptation and building resilience. Again, these are community projects. You know, we may need more greenhouses to make sure our elders get the food when they need it. If animals are moving north and we don't have the same access we did, 40 years ago. Community butchers, sharing those skills, community freezers. That's kind of the what we used to do with the old bowl and the shared spoons. And today it's a community freezer. So those are just modern ways of doing the same thing that we have, the teachings have always shared. Finally, supporting initiatives to document and share traditional knowledge, build on the land and water and ice skills. So we just have to pay attention to it. We have to document it and make sure that there's a real strategy for change. So again, I think we know we can't wait for others to do this because we've been waiting a long time and we're not seeing results. So we've seen more and more the leadership and the lands leaders and the elders take up the challenge of deciding what the strategy on the lands and waters will be and really taking up that space. We're happy to work in collaboration. Certainly I've met many First Nations who are not anti-forest or forestry or anti-mining, but it has to be organized and considered and done in a way that will last forever and in balance. So that's what's missing in a traditional colonial approach. So this is the big change that we're seeing. And I really would like now maybe, Scott, to hear from the participants, because they, of course, have way more knowledge than we do. We're just analyzing and tracking what we see and what we know so far. But there's a lot of knowledge in this room. I can feel it.
So, and opening up the floor for questions. And if I can kick things off. And first of all, Miigwech, Cynthia, Brett, for a great presentation and all the great work that's here. So here's someone who I live on traditional lands, but I don't live within the community. So here's what I hear. I'm hearing that, and my question will be, I'm going to get there to it. My question will be, how can government collaborate better with First Nation communities regarding food insecurity and some of the effects of climate change? So that's my question. Now, let me put sort of my question in a bit of a context. What I hear when I'm at the forum on many occasions is, and you've sort of highlighted this, that First Nation communities are coming to the government and saying, look, our rivers are drying up, fur colors aren't changing, animals are confused, all parasites are in young walleye now. There's a lot of these things. What's going on? Or there's a landfill upstream in the Thames that's affecting our water security. When I hear, and we're going to have a government presentation in just a moment, what I hear from representatives from the government, they say they have been working on these things and they provide consultation on an ongoing basis. The part that confuses me, that someone standing on the outside watching this, is it seems like the two parties aren't communicating well. And maybe that's an obvious thing. So from your perspective, and how is it that we have these two challenges? Well, I say challenges, the government say they're communicating, First Nation communities say you're not, and you're not paying attention, and here's what's going on. How can the government be better at fixing that massive gap that you're coming in and highlighting, you know, as far as the Supreme Court?
Yeah, I think that government is very limited, and I think they're starting to realize that, but they haven't had a chance to change it yet in the way that they're organized. So, you know, they may be consulting on this particular forest plan and this particular lincod or walleye effort within their mandate, within their small, you know, region or department. And that is not talking to the herbicide spraying that's happening in the same region. It's not talking to the impacts of the zebra mussels in the same region. There's no overarching relationship. So one thing that the leadership of the First Nation does much, much better is always look at that interconnectedness. But when we try to go to the Crown to speak, they say, well, that's not my mandate. We've got to call eight other people. And they don't even know who the eight other people that to call. So we've started just insisting that there are high level, what we call relationship tables, that will sit down and look and bring to us all the different eight people that you think have the expertise to add in. And in the meantime, think about reorganizing your whole structure to focus on the interconnectedness, because you're really missing that. And the court's telling you, you've missed it. So that's our message to government on every level, whether it's a small meeting or a large meeting or at the Supreme Court. You need to stop working in small mandates and stovepipes because you're not able to get results and make change.
When we first started this conference some 6+ years ago, one of the things that we did from a design, Jason and his group did from a design perspective, was that we were breaking the Anishinaabeg Nation into three different sectors. So we asked government presenting that they had to go to the Southern group, Northern and Far North group, because each sector had a different lens of what was taking place, say transportation. Because once we get into the Northern groups, they're talking about ice roads, and Southern groups, they're talking about, you know, blasting highways through traditional lands. So it was really fascinating because we received a little bit of pushback on that about why would we have to move from room to room to room? And it sort of gave a concept of, yeah, because roads in Southern Ontario are far different from Northern Ontario. So I love what you said, Cynthia, about this collaborative table. And I see it from Sam Manitowabe. How can we get Ontario to agree to implement the SCC decision on the Blueberry First Nation case?
Mm-hmm. Good question. So the Blueberry River case luckily did not go to the Supreme Court because the province did not appeal it. They decided to sit down and negotiate after they got the decision of the court that it was a treaty right and the cumulative impacts needed to be respected. This one that went to the Supreme Court was the carbon tax or the climate change impacts, where we went and said at the Supreme Court that the pollution, guess what, doesn't stop at the provincial border. So the federal government has to have a role with First Nations to deal with climate change across all of Canada. So that those were two different cases. But on the Blueberry River issue, I think we just bring that to Ontario and say, you know, if you want us to litigate and take you through all that litigation, we can. But here's an example from BC where they sat down and put the money into fixing the problem instead of, you know, 5 to 10 years of litigation. I think that that's a real political push that's going to happen after Blueberry River in each province across Canada. So we just have to force them. If they don't go, then we have the big stick of litigation again.
Well, Miigwetch, we're going to move to our government panel, which is probably going, oh, great.
Well,
right after the Westaway lawyers. Great.
Yeah, sorry about that. But no, our government colleagues and I was a legal counsel for the federal government for a number of years. So there's a lot of good work that happens internally, but they need us sometimes to write those letters and say, hey, give us a joint team. We know that you're struggling with a mandate that's too limited. So I think they're actually quite happy to have us there. And we're always saying, how can we help you? What kind of letters can we write to support a joint collaborative effort? We want to, we don't live alone on this land. We have non-Indigenous neighbors too. So we really need that collaboration. So hopefully the government will have some positive things to share.
I love the fact, Cynthia, that you drink Red Bull. If I'm going to hire a lawyer, I want my key lawyer to be pounding back a Red Bull.
Oh, I hate to disappoint you, but it's a Montpellier.
I thought it was Red Bull.
But I'll work on my Red Bull drinking. I'll try to toughen up. Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Brett.
Thank you.
Thank you both very much. Okay, so if we can stop the screen share there, Brett, that'd be great. Thank you so much. That was a terrific presentation. Next, we're moving on to Ontario Relationship with Anishinaabeg Nation, Ministry Updates presentation. Lori Churchill is with us now, and Lori is the Director of Indigenous Consultation and Partnership Branch. So Lori, we set the stage perfectly for you, from the lawyers now over to the government. So I know you have a number of colleagues that you'll be introducing, and if we have questions, please put it in the Q&A section. That allows us to track it, and we'll also save some room for some questions as well. So Lori Churchill, I'll hand it over to you.
Good morning. And actually, you did set the stage a little bit for us because we're not nervous at all. We actually are excited to be able to come together to you today as an Ontario team from multiple ministries to provide updates and talk a little bit about our relationship as well. I do want to acknowledge, though, that this gathering, while virtual, has Ontario team participating across the province on lands traditionally used and occupied by numerous Indigenous nations. We're grateful to have the opportunity to live and work on this territory, and we'll continue to be mindful of the opportunity that we have as public servants to foster reconciliation and increased awareness. From my own perspective, Mines and Minerals Division have been working with the Anishinaabeg Nation since 2014, and not just at the Joint Advisory Council with the leadership, but across the province at the regional roundtables. So I remember that that forum, Scott, in North Bay, where we rotated the rooms, and it was something that that we were excited about, because we're already meeting with the regions, appreciating and understanding that there are different needs and different perspectives on the different developments that are across the province. I think Bob Jeffrey has taken control of the screen, has the presentation up. Hopefully everyone can hear me okay, see the presentation okay. Today we have a number of ministry participants, like I said, coming together as one to talk about the community projects, procurements, information and relationship tables, and in a bit of an information exchange on the topics themselves. So in the effort of trying to buy a little bit of time to provide my co-presenters with the opportunity to get through their slides, I'm going to hand it over to Robert Derbyshire for slide 3 and ask that my colleagues introduce themselves first and where they're from briefly before jumping into their the slides that they will be speaking to today. So again, thank you everyone. Looking forward to the discussion and the chat and the questions as we go forward.
Hi, thank you, Laurie. Hi, everyone. Pleasure to be here. My name is Rob Derbyshire. I'm a senior policy advisor at the Ministry of Indigenous Affairs in the Strategic Planning and Economic Policy branch. Been with this ministry for a number of years. Had the pleasure to work at the Chiefs of Ontario for a couple of years. I'm originally from Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario. I now call Toronto my home, and I'm happy to be here. I know we've got a lot of information to go through, so happy to kick it off. Hopefully this will be viewed as some good news. Most of these programs will be, I'm sure, not unfamiliar to most of you, but you know, happy to talk through this and answer any questions. So I'm here to, that's good to see you as well, Barrett. I'm here to talk a little bit about some of our ministry's programs focused on economic development, consultation, engagement, support. And most of these are actually accepting applications now, so I'll talk about that. In fact, all of them are, so it's pretty exciting time for us and a busy time. So first is the Indigenous Economic Development Fund. This has been around for about 8 years. It's been a very successful program. Over 180 projects have been funded since that time through three streams. And so we've got the economic diversification stream, which basically provides support to communities and Indigenous organizations to help diversify their economy, build economic development strategies, help plan, help support capacity development, and just general economic development project support. The other stream that we have as a part of the IDF is the Regional Partnerships Grant. And this is dedicated to supporting more partnerships between Indigenous organizations and communities and either the private sector or non-Indigenous organizations, with a focus on supporting employment, skills training, and education projects. So this is something that we've heard from partners over the years has been a great boon for community development around supporting entrepreneurship, employment supports. And so that's something that we've seen a great take up on as well. And then the third stream is not an application based per se. It supports, it provides direct funding to the Ontario, the Aboriginal financial institutions here in Ontario. And there's 8 of them. And they're doing some fantastic work. And since the program launched, we provided about $50 million to the AFIs. And last year, we were able to get approval for an additional increase of $10 million specifically for the AFIs to provide low and zero interest loans with a mix of grants, non-repayable component, as well as financing. To support Indigenous businesses who've been impacted by COVID. And so that was something that was really seen as a positive step, and we've seen a huge uptake. So, and so the window for applications in that is actually open. It launched February 8th, and I believe it closes March 9th for those two streams. The New Relationships Fund is something that's been around for quite some time. I know everyone on the call here would likely be familiar with it. It provides funding directly to communities and some organizations. I think about $85,000 per year to support capacity and to hire consultation experts, engagement experts, focused on helping a community be in a better position to work with resource sector businesses and the government around consultation practices. And so, you know, this program has gone through a couple of different iterations over the years. And, you know, certainly we've heard from partners that the funding needs to be increased. And so, you know, we're always looking to explore new ways to be able to augment this. I know we'll be talking about the participation fund as well, but we've got some other ideas too. So it's an exciting time for us at IO and the government as well. And then finally, to round out the programming, we've got the Indigenous Community Capital Grants Program. So this has been around for quite some time, even before our ministry, but it was redesigned and relaunched in 2016. Since then, provided over $11 million in funding to over 90 small and large sized projects. And this provides funding directly to both on and off reserve communities and organizations to support infrastructure projects. So the sort of the full spectrum of the build, the sort of design plan, you know, design, the build, and then the plan stage. And so that we've seen some great success there as well. And that program is also open for intake, similar to the IDF. It launched in, it opened in February, early February, and will close March 9th. So I've provided a link there on the slide. I'd encourage anyone, if you've not looked at it as an opportunity for funding for your community or for your organization, please do so. If you're a small business or you're trying to engage small businesses, please have them contact the most appropriate AFI. They've got a lot of great resources and financing and grants to help support businesses. So again, happy to be here and yeah, down and dirty, but I'm happy to have talked about this. So thank you.
I think George is up next. There he is.
Hello. Can you guys hear me and see me?
Yep.
Great. So thanks, everybody. It's a great opportunity to be here. I'm George Ferreira with the Ministry of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs. I'm an economic development specialist with a focus on Indigenous engagement and relationships. So prior to my time at OMAFRA, that's the acronym for Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs, I worked in the Kiewit Nikilkamakana communities. Those are Nan communities in Northwestern Ontario, where I was sort of introduced to the need to address issues around food security and the potential role that government has in it and that hadn't been realized and has not been realized. I'm originally from Toronto and Guelph's my home now. So let me just start with a bit of background because OMAFRA is new to the relationship with the Anishinaabeg Nation. And so this partnership with AN has really helped us move forward through to the development of an Indigenous engagement and relations strategy. So traditionally, OMAFRAs had minimal engagement with Indigenous communities and organizations, typically focused around Six Nations, where you have sort of high yield farming. Manitoulin Island is another sort of pocket of traditional, what we would call quote unquote traditional farming. And obviously the aquaculture sector, which is very strongly dominated by Indigenous entrepreneurs. So we've moved this strategy forward and we're in the process. We've just had our policy framework approved and to focus on establishing strong trust-based relationships with Indigenous communities and organizations. And again, a lot of this does stem from our ongoing relationship with AAN and positioning ourselves to revitalize our policy capacity around dealing with Indigenous concerns. Again, enhancing those opportunities and programs that we have that have been traditionally targeted at settler farming and farming practices, and unless those Indigenous farmers were engaged in those kinds of agriculture, there's not a lot of programming within OMAFRA to support. To support that, hence the development of the TPAs, right? So the two TPAs that we have, the two TPAs I'm going to talk about today, were funded through the Grassroots Growth Program. Essentially, that is an initiative to ensure the sustainability of agriculture, the focus on agriculture, and rural and remote communities, and it's designed to support organizations to deliver on areas that the ministry has been traditionally incapable of delivering on. It's sort of a way to address some of those gaps. So go to the next slide, please. Thank you. So the first TPA was from 2018 to 2020. And that was less about capacity building than it was about identifying opportunities, needs, wants, and barriers. And before I go any further, let me just say that this is not work that was done by OMAFRA. This is work that's been done by Anishinaabeg Nation leadership, under the leadership of Jason and Rhonda and Lynn doing the sort of the heavy lifting there. What I'm talking about here is work that you guys are doing and that we've tried to support as well as we can, either through funding and through providing technical support. So that first TPA was from 2018 to 2020. And again, that was less about capacity building and more about identifying opportunities, needs and wants of the AAN member communities, and also identifying barriers to participation. And also, what are the needs that we are not addressing as a ministry? So the key areas that were identified were capacity building and skills development and training, with the knowledge that, it's not all just about soil farming. There are a lot of opportunities in science, technology, engineering, math, in new approaches to food production and processing and aquaculture, and greenhouses and a high yield indoor production, vertical farming. So food security and sovereignty is obviously a big issue. And how to support small and medium scale food production. That's something that traditionally we've not been terribly focused on as a ministry, but that is evolving. So business development and marketing, poultry has been an issue an interest that's been expressed. Aquaculture, 14 out of the 19 large-scale aquaculture operations in Ontario are Indigenous owned. And aquaponics, for those of you who are not familiar with that, is the use of fish. it's a circular system that utilizes tanked fish to provide nutrients and grow plants indoors. And also a focus on traditional foods such as wild rice, honey, maple syrup, and other forest foods. The outcome of that TPA was significant for us, not only in the results, but also it culminated in a bilateral leadership forum between our minister at the time and the chief, your grand chief at the time. The outcome of that was ultimately a commitment to continue working together in a mutually respectful way, and to build trust with an acknowledgement that the trust may not be there, but a commitment to continue to build that and going forward with that spirit. Next slide, please. So this second TPA, which just started this past summer, is going to be for the next 3 years. And it's really about putting the meat on the bones of that first TPA. And this is sort of where you move into the action. And the focus here really is an economic development strategy that you guys are calling an agri-food economic blueprint to support agriculture, local food, agri-food development, food security, and public engagement by your member communities. So how do you do this? I guess the key objectives would be to increase awareness and knowledge of opportunities. encourage and increase local agri-food economic development, seek and make available training opportunities and skills needed to enhance the 39 communities' involvements in the agri-food sector. And youth, again, has been identified as a very important factor going forward. So we do have a number of programs that I'm not going to talk about today, but maybe that's a topic for next year, but I will leave it at that. And thank you.
Thanks, George. Next is Sherry.
Hello, thank you for having me this morning. So my name is Sherry Marr. I'm with the Ministry of Transportation Ontario. MTO is our acronym. I am the manager of our procurement solutions office, and I work with our program areas, providing advice and guidance on procurement and programs and measures and steps that they can take to engage and include individual vendors, such as Indigenous vendors, in the procurement process. I'm speaking to you today about the Aboriginal Procurement Program. The program is available to all ministries in the provincial government. It was established in 2015 to increase opportunities for Indigenous vendors to conduct business with the Ontario government and to help them strengthen capacity, skills, knowledge, and partnerships to become more competitive in the marketplace. The MTO has an extensive transportation network that allows for unique economic opportunities for Indigenous vendors. Over 70% of spend under the Aboriginal Procurement Program has been attributed to MTO, which is worth over $55 million. The maintenance of the transportation network generates a number of procurement opportunities for vendors operating construction and maintenance services, things as culvert replacements, aggregate production, equipment rentals, contract administration are some examples of those procurements. And while these are the most common procurements at MTO that use the Aboriginal Procurement Program, the application is across all types of procurement spend, not limited to our construction program. The eligibility for the program considers two broad categories, Aboriginal supply source and Aboriginal procurement criteria. So when looking at procurement, there's a question, is there an Aboriginal supply source for the required goods, services, or construction? And will that procurement be a significant benefit or have significant effect to Indigenous people? Are there business, employment, and or training opportunities are considered? Also, is the procurement designated for Indigenous peoples? So an example might be facilitation services for Indigenous engagement. And we also consider, is the procurement culturally specific? Is it Indigenous art or cross-cultural workshops are some examples of culturally specific procurement. Once we have identified that the procurement is eligible for the Aboriginal Procurement Program, there are really four methods of procurement that can be applied. We look at participation requirements. The participation requirements is a method that uses incentives or mandatory requirements under the contract for bidders competing, requiring them to engage and contract a portion of the goods or the services specified in the procurement to an Aboriginal vendor or vendors. So participation that MTO has used in the past includes bridge replacement, highway rehabilitation projects, and on-the-job training for construction contract administration. Another method that can be utilized is preferential criteria. So preferential criteria is a method used when MTO is seeking proposals from bidders that includes a technical evaluation in addition to the price. So the evaluation and scoring of the proposals includes the bidder's proposal to include Indigenous participation and Indigenous vendors in their completion and performance of that contract. The ministry has used this method when procuring contracts such as highway area highway maintenance contracts. So that's those snow plowing, winter operations, or grass cutting, bridge washing, a number of activities that maintain our highway infrastructure. We've also used evaluation criteria in delivery models for design, build, construction services. So in these scenarios, there are additional points allocated to those contractors who are including Indigenous vendors in their solution. So the third, a third method is what's called the limited competition among Aboriginal vendors. Sometimes this is referred to as a limited set aside. It is a limited competition that's only open to Aboriginal vendors. So where the goods or the services are also outside a specific community, and there is capacity for a number of Aboriginal vendors to compete for that opportunity. So we have used this as well. MTOs use this for advanced clearing work, aggregate crushing, and Indigenous translation services. It would be another example where that method's been employed. And lastly, the last method is a single or sole source method. So this is a method where procurement is awarded to an Aboriginal vendor without competition. So where the Aboriginal vendor can provide the required goods or services, and there's a significant benefit and value that is achieved for all parties involved. The ministry has used this method for a number of works in the remote northern airports, also equipment rentals, and a number of construction and operational sources of work. Overall, MTO has been successful in using APP. We continue to learn and increase the use of the Aboriginal Procurement Program. And happy to report that we have seen a number of successes, and we'd like to see to continue that going forward.
Thank you. And thank you. I think Lindley's next, and highlighting some of the initiatives, some other initiatives.
Thanks, Bob. Hi, my name is Lindley Kenny, and I'm a manager in the Indigenous Relations Branch. So some of you might be familiar with engaging with our operations division on a project by project basis. But I'm here today from our Indigenous Relations Branch to share with you our new Transportation Initiatives Fund, in addition to our regional roundtable model. So on the note of the Transportation Initiatives Fund, last year MTO launched a competitive application-based funding program called the Transportation Initiative Fund to encourage Indigenous communities or organizations to put forward transportation-related project proposals that help address communities' needs and prioritize key areas of interest related to transportation. The intent of this transfer payment is to really enable Indigenous communities to advance their transportation-related initiatives and really encourage capacity building and involve culturally and locally responsive solutions. So the funding is fairly flexible and can be used towards initiatives that benefit Indigenous peoples in urban centers, rural or reserve-based settings. And so the proposed projects in terms of the funding must be related to the transportation sector and demonstrate a connection to one or more of the priority themes for the funding. So the three priority themes that the application would need to connect with would be economic development or recovery, transportation mobility, and community and or community well-being and transportation safety. We really encourage communities or organizations to apply, and we've saw very unique applications that fit into these three broad one of these three broad categories. And so last year was the launch year of this transfer payment fund, and we're going into the second intake year of 2022 and 2023. And so applicants can apply to one of two funding streams. So there's the small project stream, which are projects worth a maximum of $30,000. Or large project streams for applications at a maximum of $75,000. So the application form can be found on Transfer Payment Ontario, so TPON, and completed applications for this intake year has a deadline of February 23rd. So we just encourage you, if you haven't had a chance in the previous intake year, to either attend our information center sessions regarding this fund, or if you want to discuss with us one-on-one to learn more about this fund, we're more than happy to set up those one-on-one meetings, but we just encourage anyone and everyone to apply. And then if you can just switch the slide, thanks. And then I also wanted to discuss here today, MTO launched regional roundtable last April. So in March and April of last year, we launched our regional roundtables initiative, and really the purpose of these regional roundtables are to have a regular engagement forum between MTO and Indigenous communities that are focused within the region, that are not just project by project specific discussions, which seem to have been occurring to date, but really the regional roundtables are an opportunity to discuss key transportation topics or themes outside of those project by project consultation meetings that the ministry has. And really the goal of regional roundtables is an opportunity for MTO and Indigenous communities to really share information and engage in an open dialogue on specific priorities and areas of interest related to transportation. So far, we've had two regional roundtables, and we've appreciated all of the communities that have been able to attend to date. And we've had really thoughtful discussions on the Aboriginal Procurement Program, the First Nations Roads Program, MTO's approach to driver examination services, and also Indigenous language supports in driver's license testing. So these regional roundtables will continue to occur on a biannual basis. So we would just really encourage any communities that are interested in attending to attend. And we also are looking to hear of future topics or areas of concern that we could bring as part of the regional roundtables to really ensure that we're providing the information that communities are looking for, and also incorporating the feedback and concerns raised through these sessions into these programs. Thank you.
Thank you. And I think now it's me next. Just a second here. So I'm Bob Jeffrey with the Ministry of Northern Development Mines.
Sorry, Bob. Bob, just a quick question. I had to step away for a few minutes, and I've returned, and I didn't get the beginning part of this Ontario slot of presentations, but just referring to the chair, are we able to ask questions to the presentations, or do you want them asked at the end? How is this being moderated?
My understanding is that we were going to do questions at the end and trying to get
leave time for thank that. You.
Yeah. And as in other situations, I think people are putting questions in the chat, and so we can look to address those as well. Okay. So as I was saying, Bob Jeffrey, I'm a senior advisor in the Indigenous Relations Consultation Branch of the mining side of the ministry, Mineral and Mines Division. And I'd like to, I'm out of Sudbury, and I'd like to thank Elder Evelyn for her comments, and as well as Alan and Cynthia and Brett for the presentations. Just want to highlight some of the work that we're doing with the Anishinaabeg Nation, and I think people will know that there's a lot of other work that's happening with Mining Division, different from the things that I'm highlighting here. So I'm just trying to highlight the things that we've been working on during the last number of years. And one of them is the Rehabilitation Action Plan. And this is a three-pronged approach where we're bringing in information on the program, how it runs at the regional roundtables, as well as the Joint Advisory Committee. And then we've also hosted, that program has also hosted some specific calls on specific projects with communities in the area. And there's even some communities have gone out on site visits as well. We've also developing a process with the Anishinaabeg Nation for notifying not just the communities within the area of the project, but also others in terms of procurement opportunities that are coming up. And this participation has sort of led us into getting involved with the economic regional roundtables, economic development officers regional roundtables. And in that one, we're working on developing an action plan to support procurement with Ontario projects like MTO and with our ministry and potentially others. So that's one of the main initiatives. And just the other area just to highlight is we have the Aboriginal Participation Fund. And right now there are three Anishinaabeg Nation communities that have mineral development advisors, and our understanding, and I believe there's a number of other applications right now in and that are being processed through. That fund also supports the through the education relationship building stream, the regional roundtables for mining, as well as the Joint Advisory Committee. And the other significant project I want to highlight is the land use and occupancy, often called the values mapping project, that Rhonda and group are supporting. And I think the slide says there's seven communities involved, I believe. Rhonda can correct me, but there's either 9 or 10 at Nelson involved in that project. So that, like I said, these are just some of the highlights. There's lots of other activities that our division is doing, but this is some of the work with the Anishinaabeg Nation and some of the member communities. I'll pass it over to Terry next.
Thanks, Bob. Ani, good morning. My name is Terry McDonald, and I am the manager of the Indigenous Relations Unit in Laurie Churchill's branch, also based out of Sudbury, and working closely with both her and Bob for purposes of the ministry's work with the Anishinaabeg Nation through the regional roundtables and the Joint Advisory Committee. So we've got a couple more highlights on this slide, and you will see that the first one here really was intended to be a high-level update on the opportunities to share information from Ontario's Resource Revenue Sharing Team to the Anishinaabeg Nation since the minister's letter last fall. I do want to acknowledge that I had the opportunity to hear some of the panel discussion yesterday morning, and I think it's important for me to say that I heard and I acknowledge the comments made by leadership and the perspective shared from both Grand Council Chief and each of the regional deputy Grand Council Chiefs. So I just want to say thank you for that. My colleagues and I will be taking back what we have heard and sharing it with the team that have been working on RRS to share information through the meetings that are referenced on this slide here. All to say that I now fully appreciate that the last sentence in this section on slide 11 may no longer be the preferred next step for leadership. So we will seek to confirm that with you. The next section, critical minerals. So some of you may be aware that the ministry released a discussion paper last March on developing a critical mineral strategy for Ontario. And there were a number of information sessions held last spring and fall and distinctly with the Anishinaabeg Nation and member communities as well. So we really appreciate all of the work from the nation to both review the discussion paper and to provide some really comprehensive and valuable feedback. So current status there is that the Critical Mineral Strategy Unit has been actively considering all of the feedback that they have received and now also putting pen to paper to try and draft that strategy. Worth noting as well that as a result of the feedback and the discussions through that process, there are now a few related proposals before the ministry for consideration. For example, the process for recovery of critical minerals and a graduated regulatory approach to mine closure requirements, again, for critical minerals. So we anticipate more discussion with the Anishinaabeg Nation and member communities as those proposals are considered. So stay tuned for that. And I will turn it over to my colleague, Leah.
You're on mute, Leah.
Man, you know, 20 years in this pandemic, and this is the first time it's happened to me. And of course, it happens with such a large group, eh? Anyways, my name is Leah Schmidt. I am an area team manager up in Northeastern Ontario with the Regional Economic Development Branch with the Northern Development Division. I'm actually situated in Timmins. So I'm just here today to talk to you about how our division has been working with Anishinaabeg Nation, both as an organization as a whole, as well as with the individual members. So just quickly, the Northern Development Division has a history of working with the nation, mostly to identify economic development opportunities, but also to access and navigate the different government funding programs that are available to the nation and its member communities. Right now, the division is supporting Anishinaabeg Nation's Economic Blueprint Revitalization Project, which is ongoing. And the spirit of this project is to develop capacity building and economic development and an economic development blueprint for its membership. In the past, we've also supported the nation through several internships, mostly around communication and fundraising efforts for the seventh generation charity as well. Just next slide, Bob. So I just spoke about how the division's been able to support Anishinaabeg Nation at an organizational level, but we also work really hard with the individual member communities to help them access funding programs through specifically the Northern Ontario Heritage Fund Corporation, or you may know it as NOHFC. This particular agency actually sits within our Northern Development Division, so we have a very intimate understanding of the programs available and eligibility and things like that. So this slide really highlights some of the past programs that we've had available to Anishinaabeg Nation member communities, as well as the ones that are currently available. But I thought it was good to highlight some of the ones in the past as well, since it it demonstrates the historical relationship we've had with Anishinaabeg Nation member communities. So just quickly, we in the past, we funded communities through the Northern Community Capacity Building Program, which really looked to help communities develop capacity to promote and attract business. We also provided support through the Strategic Economic Infrastructure Program, which looked to support infrastructure projects that create jobs and build capacity. And then lastly, we also had something called the Northern Internship Program, which is where some of the Anishinaabeg Nation internships were funded through. And that was looking at strengthening the competitive advantage in the North, as well as retaining and attracting talent to the North. So these programs, they've been sunset. However, we've been able to support a number of communities through those programs in the past. And in 2020, NOHFC launched a brand new suite of programs. So I just wanted to highlight these ones here too, because they are currently open and available to all member communities to apply for. Specifically, there's the Indigenous Workforce Development Stream, which is very similar to the Northern Internship Program. However, it's specific to the Indigenous workforce, which I think is pretty important for you all. There's also the Community Enhancement Program, and this looks to help build strong and resilient communities through infrastructure investment that seek to improve community quality of life, as well as economic development, which is a bit different than the previous ones, but I really like this program because it looks at quality of life and how that actually brings into play economic development as well, which is really unique, I find. And then lastly, there's also the Cultural Supports Program. And I thought this may be of interest to you all as well, because this program really looks to provide funding to communities that want to host events that increase the community profile as well as promote economic development. I know a number of communities in the North do a lot of really amazing events, and that there's funding available for you as well. So I believe there is a contact slide at the very end if any of the member communities or if anyone from Anishinaabeg Nation wants additional information about the different funding opportunities that our division can help support. You can just reach out to me directly and I'll put you in contact with the appropriate Northern Development Advisor. And yes, there is an actual person at the other end of those computers that will reach out and navigate the whole process with you. So thanks, Bob.
Thank you very much, Leah. Now, Jason Cavisto.
Yeah, hey, Bob.
On his phone.
Yeah, I'm trying to get the video to work, but I'm not sure it's going to, but here, I'll see if it'll work. Even if it doesn't. There you go.
You're on. Oh, you're on.
Okay, great. So, Jason Cavisto, I'm with the other side of NDM and NRF, the Natural Resources and Forestry side team. I work on a number of files, and I also live near, relatively close to Sault Ste. Marie, and what I would be the traditional territories of either the Garden River First Nation and or the Thessalon First Nation. Sorry, Laurie, your chance. I can't read that. But anyway, hopefully you can, hopefully this is going to work, but, and I apologize if it doesn't. So my team works a lot on supporting sustainable growth. So this is Ontario's forest sector strategy. A number of communities have been engaged in working with us on this over the years, and when we were consulting on it back before the pandemic times, which seems so very long ago now. anyway, so through the strategy, we've been working with Indigenous peoples to look for, and communities to look for way, and organizations to, across the province, to foster economic development in the forest sector. So this is done largely through supporting communities to identify their own priorities and try to find ways to where we can help to assist them. As an example of this, we've supported, been working with the Mishpikatan First Nation to support them on a community-led project that's using forest biomass for a heating project. We also work on ways to support community participation in forest economic development by working with Indigenous communities and businesses and organizations to provide training opportunities and support business development. As an example of this, Ontario has supported organizations including the Ogokee Development Corporation, Wikwayam Mekong's Department of Lands and Natural Resources, and a youth sawmill project in Pikangikum, with training and skills development work. And it's important to identify the project-specific capacity building and training and skills development needs to ensure that the right programs and support are provided. As a ministry, we've also been working with communities on economic development and their economic development organizations to build business partnerships in the forest sector. An example of some of this work has been funding technical support for Wikwayam Mekong to work with local sawmills and heavy industry on a biomass proposal that some of you are probably familiar with. On the next slide, Bob, if you can. Thanks very much. So the ministry has also gradually increased over many years the amount of wood that's harvested under license to indigenous, or wood harvest under licensing to indigenous communities across the province. Most of the management units now have harvest licenses that are held by indigenous communities, entrepreneurs, and or community development organizations. In 2003, harvest allocations amounted to about 1 million cubic meters per year, so only about 4% of Ontario's allowable harvest. And in 2019, that grew to 5 million cubic meters and was made available to Indigenous communities and businesses. So that's about 17%. And then we've also been working through the forest sector strategy to begin in the past year, working with what's called the Forest Sector Strategy Committee. And so this group is helps to try and identify priorities and or pathways to implementation. The committee includes Indigenous members to ensure that Indigenous perspectives are included in the identification of these priorities and as well. So, and opportunities to and measures to build on capacity for Indigenous community or Indigenous businesses to is a key consideration in projects that we look to support through the FSS. So providing information to Indigenous communities and businesses to support programming, regulatory requirements, business planning, and to help make connections to other provincial and federal programs is key for us. Facilitating connections between industry and Indigenous communities to support the development of mutually beneficial partnerships and business arrangements is also important, and helping to identify and access wood supply required for community projects. We also have a working group that is made up of industry and Indigenous representatives supporting some forest bioeconomy work that we're doing, and that started a little over a year ago to work on the development of what's called the Forest Biomass Action Plan. A draft of that was posted on the Environmental Registry in May of last year and also was shared extensively with a number of communities to help get their insights and try to engage them and look for ways to support participation and deriving benefit from forest biomass projects into the future. I think I'll leave it at that, Bob, and hand it back over to you.
Thank you very much, Jason. And so this is the last slide. I think Terry, maybe, I don't know if you wanted to add any last comments.
Sure, thanks, Bob. I think Leah mentioned earlier, so this slide obviously includes our contact information for everyone who has presented today. So feel free to reach out if there are further questions that we don't get a chance to get to today during the session. I do want to really thank you, Bob, for your efforts in organizing us on the Ontario Ministry side to support our participation today, and to Miigwech to the Nation for the invitation, both for today's session and really for the entirety of the forum. It's always a fantastic lineup. We really appreciate the opportunity not just to share, but to hear and understand the perspectives, needs, and opportunities for the Anishinaabeg Nation and member communities going forward.
Miigwech, Terry, let's dive into a couple of questions with the limited time we have here. First one, very important. Stitch asked about delivering Bob a castle hat. What is a castle hat, Bob? We would all like to know what a castle hat is.
A castle hat?
Yeah, he says, yeah. Stitch said, Ani, Bob, I still have your castle hat to deliver.
Oh, okay.
What's a castle hat?
I'm not sure what he's referring to.
Don't make me put Stitch on.
I understand. We'll have to. I'll private message Stitch and get the reference. He's probably said it, and I just don't know what reference he's got.
Okay. How would you like to tackle some of the questions here? We have one of our yes, Bob. Do you want to do that?
But actually, if you read them out, that'll help me because I have to figure out who is the right people to call on to answer, if that's helpful.
Roger that. So first question, will MTO be including First Nations on signs that indicate distance to, i.e. mileage signs?
I can take that question. So we, MTO definitely is interested in meeting with communities to discuss opportunities of ensuring that there's mileage marker signs. We also have had discussions with communities on enhanced boundary signs and community billboard signage requests as well. So we definitely do that. So anyone that's interested in having follow-up discussions on those particular interests, I can definitely set up that meeting following this.
Jason Laurent has a question. Jason, I'll open up to your question now.
Thank you. Appreciate that. So this is for the MTO question, and thank you, Lindley, for your presentation. Appreciate that. I think what I'd really like to do here is open up, you know, the idea about building relationships. And I appreciate that this format and as an Anishinaabe Nation, maybe I'll explain kind of a backgrounder on how things are. I mean, you're new into this work that we're doing with Ontario and the relationships we have with our sector ministries. We used to have a relationship with MTO, and I think what was alarming for me in your presentation was the lack of relationship building with our First Nation communities and, you know, and the relationship we once had with you. And I think I'm hoping that maybe in the future, in the near future that, you know, we can build not only with us as a PTO, but others as well, in terms of building that relationship. You know, in your presentation, and I'm just going off a blank memory on some thoughts about what your presentation was about, but I did notice that you had some regional forums that you were doing that was to engage with First Nation communities. And I think what I really want to hit home on here is the opportunity when it comes down to working with First Nation communities, and I'm not going to say you stole the regional context for there, but I strongly feel that it was from the relationship we had with MTO, where we did the regional roundtables, and MTO was part of our regional roundtable format that we had, and then later on our relationship went different ways. And a relationship partnership went different ways. And then now we see MTO coming out trying to do their own thing on establishing relationships with First Nations. I'm going to tell you what you guys are doing is wrong. And I don't mean to turn this into a mudslinging thing. I think it's important that we understand the parameters for engagement with our communities is important. And I know all the other secular ministries here, we have a relationship with, and they understand the parameters for building that relationship or enhancing the partnerships that we have. So what I'm hoping that, you know, that happens out of this and that you can take back to your superiors, because I've talked to, I had many discussions with some folks within your ministry and deputy ministers and ADMs and stuff like that, where we've talked and we built this relationship over a number of years, and then it's not there. My concern is that the ministry's taken a backward approach to trying to resolve matters, right? So I think for us, I'm hoping that, you know, my comments here are not necessarily, like I said, to be a mudslinging opportunity, but more or less, the opportunity that we have you here on this amongst other peered ministries with you is for education and information purposes, right? And we're hoping that, you know, that there is opportunities to work with MTO down in the near future, because it is a large file. We understand the MTO ministry is also one of the more, I'll say, richest ministries in terms of the resources and things like that are being extracted. And, we are seeing the least amount of participation and partnerships with them. So I'm not going to kind of drown in and get into the weeds, but it's really about relationship building at the end of the day. To me, it's having that partnership and the ability to engage with our communities. The last thing I'll leave you with, and everyone knows it on this panel, that any relationship or context of engaging with First Nations, we know how to engage with our First Nations better than anybody. When government attempts to go on their own and do an engagement, it doesn't always, it's more or less a false narrative to consultation with First Nations on there, and it's not really done in a meaningful way. So I'm just venting and sharing kind of some thoughts about, you know, having to get back to the table and creating those partnerships. But at the same time, we need to look at how those things are done best. So, Miigwech.
Did you want a comment on that, Jason, or just leave it at that?
I mean, we can leave it at that. Lindley, I don't believe that, you know, it's fair for you to have to brunt all that and share it and, you know, defend the ministry. It's not about you personally. It's about the relationship that needs to take place with our community. So, thank you much.
So,
I can respond quickly. Yeah. Sorry. Thanks so much, Jason, and I really appreciate you sharing that. And I recognize that I think up until 2020 that the MTO did have a transfer payment relationship table with AN, and so I recognize that's no longer, and I'm committed to sharing these concerns to leadership within our ministry, because I really do empathize with the concerns that you raised, and all I can say is that I'll bring those forward internally.
Lori, what would you like to do here? Do we have a couple more minutes to answer questions, or would you like to answer these offline and directly to the people?
We can do either. I mean, if we're provided the questions, I mean, I think we probably captured them through the folks that are on the call here, and we can follow up directly.
Yeah.
Or I think it's 12:01. I mean, I know folks have lunch, but we're prepared to stay. I mean, again, the opportunity to have everyone together is always something we value. So.
Well, because someone put one in the Q&A, I'm going to use that just because that's what we like, where people put the question. So let's end it with this question. With the amalgamation of MNDM and natural resources and forestry, will aggregate pits regulations be amended? It is not appropriate for aggregate operations to be able to blast away and demolish hills and small mountains without consultation or environmental monitoring and screening. Who'd like to grab that one?
I don't know that we have. Jason, are you comfortable, or Gordon, in speaking to that at all? That's a different part of the ministry.
It's a different part of the ministry. Yeah, no, and we can take that back to policy division. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, the Aggregate Resources Act has its own legislation, right? But it doesn't mean that we, let's find out how we can better meet that duty to consult on those.
Okay, so
to the aggregate people, and because there is a specific part that would be best to address a question like that. Yeah. So I'd be just guessing at this point, but yes, there are concerns around that I've heard, and we'll bring that and let you know what we hear.
And we'll filter those Q&As back through Jason and Rhonda to get out to the members. That's the right way to do it. We'll look to you how best to communicate.
Wonderful. Lori, do you have any closing words? That was a terrific presentation. I can't believe you got that done in an hour when you had like 30 or 40 people presenting. I don't know. Well, it seemed like that many.
Did you want to wrap it up? I'd love to wrap it up, because I do, like I said, value the opportunity to pull together the team and try to break down. I mean, I think we don't often show publicly just how much we do work together across the ministries and how we are trying to align our processes to be more consistent, recognizing that communities, they don't have multiple ministries within themselves to be responsive. So we do take that point, for sure, and trying our best, especially in the work with the Anishinaabeg Nation and the relationship tables that we already have working well. to be more collective as an Ontario Ministry of Public Service responding. So looking forward to continue to do better for sure. Thank you, everyone.
Keep, wonderful. Lori, thank you, Miigwech, to all your members here. And I can see in the comments and everything the great deal of respect you have for one another and the good work that you're all doing. So thank you for all that. Okay, well, that brings an end to day two. I want to thank all our speakers, the teachings we've had today. Thank you so much. Evelyn, thanks for kicking things off for us today. Tomorrow is our final day of the forum, and you're going to learn about training for resiliency in emergency department. Also deliver or discover agricultural methods to combat climate change and participate in the Anishinaabeg Nation Caucus as well. So, which is always wonderful. So Chi-Miigwech to everyone on day two. Thank you for your ongoing participation. And I look forward to seeing and hearing from all of you tomorrow. So on behalf of everyone, and a thank you again for the group that made this all possible from the Land and Resources team, the 6th Annual Land and Resources Forum Day 2 is closed. Thank you. We'll see you tomorrow.
Omapi.
Omapi.